It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech. Coming up, a great show for you with Dwight Silverman, Philip Elmer-DeWitt, the return of John C. Dvorak. We'll talk about Ashley Madison. We'll talk about cyber porn. We'll talk about hoverboards and the cat purr generator. Why do cats purr? We'll find out next on TWiT.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT This Week in Tech, episode 524, recorded Sunday, August 23rd, 2015. Straight out of Back to the Future. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Intel. Small business owners can't afford to choose between A or B. If both help your business, you want A and B. With Intel-powered 2-in-1s, you get performance and mobility. Power and freedom. That's the power of and. Experience it at smallbusiness.intel.com. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/TWiT. And by Audible.com, the Internet's leading provider of audiobooks. Audible has teamed up with James Patterson to motivate reluctant readers to embrace the power of books. For more details, go to Audible.com/Patterson. And by Harry's. For guys who want a great shave experience for a fraction of what you're paying now, go to Harry's.com. Get $5 off your first purchase by entering the code TWIT5 when you check out. It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the week's tech news. And, you know, today we've got three refugees from the Ashley Madison website joining us, and I'm very excited. John C. Dvorak is here. I'm just kidding.
You are?
No, I'm not.
Actually, I have the database.
You? It's like 30 gigabytes. Yeah, it's huge. Yeah, it you downloaded the whole thing?
Oh, everybody's got the data.
The big one?
That's Dwight Silverman from the Cron, Houston.
Oh, by the way, you didn't plug noagendashow.com.
Noagendashow.com. Hey, look who else is here. It's Filmer Elmer-DeWitt.
We do that every time. You know, I looked you up in Madison. You're not there.
Oh, thank you. Actually,
you're welcome.
My wife told me she did.
Yeah.
And I said, why would you do that?
I think that's an insult.
Everybody's wife did.
Cashmere.
I had to look me up because I try out everything and, like, I forget that I've been in something to look at it to see what it's like.
That's your story,
and
right?
And I thought,
and you're sticking to it.
Did I try this out? And so I looked at
anybody that was found in there is an idiot. Because these things are all scams.
There's
all 50 men, one woman.
Yeah, well, something like that, wasn't it? Like 90% women, men?
86% men.
86%.
Yeah, I'm low.
So my wife's position is that there aren't real women in there. They're all...
There's some woman came out and said that she was hired at $35,000 a year to create characters constantly. Mm. Just every day she'd do like a, you know...
But look, it has a Trusted Security Award. It says they're right on the front. Trusted Security Award.
It's not.
And it's 100% discreet until the database goes up. Cashmere Hill on Fusion wrote an article saying we should just not look. Don't look.
Oh, that means... Avert your eyes. I'm watching Russia Today. There was one of the shows, and the girl calls the co-host out. He was on there.
Oh, jeez.
And he's like...
I'd be furious. I'd be so furious.
And he's like trying... Well, it was just research. Yeah. It was this, it was that.
Somebody sent me a note, and I don't know if this is true or not, saying that Ashley Madison was not a double opt-in system, so that others could sign you up for it, and you would appear in the database even if they did it as a prank. I don't know if is that true or is that
I'm sure it's true. I got signed up by some joker to J-Date.
Oh, God. I get worse stuff than that.
Well, anyway, I kept getting
these dating solicitations.
And not only that, I don't know how this happened, but it was J-Date, and everyone was in Syracuse. It was just a ludicrous.
Well, the guy who signed you up was in Syracuse.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, people think that's funny.
Oh, it was a laugh.
It's a hoot.
Luckily, since I get no spam, I can just blacklist it.
The only site I know of that has revealed names is Gawker. What a surprise.
They revealed names?
They've revealed names of people in the database.
Oh, a lot of there's no, there's a bunch of sites that have search engines.
A lot of sites have gone in and said, like, in my blog post, I went in and I looked at the list of government domains and found that there were five people with the city of Houston's domain who had signed up for it.
Well, that's appropriate. You're a reporter for the
Right, and that's fine. That's I didn't want to go any further.
Go further.
Really? It's like looking at the Jennifer Lawrence naked pictures. It's like you're now complicit in the whole thing.
You know, if you found if you found, say, that a city council member or the mayor of a town was in it, you know, the question becomes, are they broken any laws? Do they position themselves
as being
morally
upright?
Well, they could have also been put in there by somebody else, a political enemy.
That's right. It may not have been them themselves.
If there wasn't a verification email, which apparently there wasn't, then nothing you find there is probably, unless, I guess.
Well, if they paid by credit card.
Yeah. How did this work? Maybe you can explain.
Is it two pay per incident,
or how does that?
No, it's like all the rest of them. They're all the same.
It's a monthly fee, or
It's a monthly yearly fee, and it's cheaper.
It's the way that some of the people were identified, like Josh Duggar, was that
I wasn't going to say any names. I wasn't going to say you went there.
That's been all over the place. That's been all over the place. Mm-hmm. We had it on our site.
That has been all over the place.
They were matched up by credit card. So if they were able to match the credit card to an email address, you know,
then they pretty much have you. Then you're busted. Yeah.
Right.
All right.
If Donald Trump were on there, that would be a story.
I guess.
Yes.
You'd have to deal with it.
I guess.
He'd be more likely to buy the place.
It's not prostitution. It's not.
I'm sure the place is crawling with prostitutes.
But
it gets the guaranteed date.
But you would have to prove that, right? I mean,
you don't have to prove anything.
It's not against. I don't believe that infidelity is against the law. Maybe in Texas it might be.
In
the military,
no, it's not.
In the military, it is.
And there were a lot of military, .mil domains in those emails.
There is an indictment of somebody who signs up with his government address or his military address.
That's the indictment. Right. They're guilty of stupidity.
But what's the tech angle on this story? That they claimed it was secure and safe. They even have that trusted, verified.
I think the tech angle is that everything's like this.
If you put something online, you can't guarantee it's safe, it's security, it's privacy.
I think anyone who trusts any of these sites, I think one of these days the big bust is going to be Facebook.
Amazon.
Amazon's interesting, but Facebook, you know, because they never throw anything away on Facebook. At least that's what they say. So all your crazy personal photos that you have supposedly deleted can all be brought back, and it'd be pretty interesting.
That's the privacy one. The financial one would be Amazon. Because it is.
They have credit card numbers.
They have credit card numbers.
That's true.
Is it possible to, if you're Jeff Bezos or Tim Cook, say, look, I don't care what it costs, this must be secure. Is it possible to do that?
No. It's impossible.
So there's nothing that would be hacker-proof.
If it's on the internet, it's not possible.
Yeah, interesting.
I mean, you could just...
We had this conversation. We had this conversation with somebody who is an expert, Steve Gibson. And... I said, is there anything Sony Pictures Entertainment could have done differently? Well, there's a lot they could have done differently, but is there anything they could have done that would have been sufficient? And then the counterexample I use is Shelley Adelson, creator of Comdex, sold Comdex for a little bit of money, and then built casinos in Macau that were just cash cows. His Sands casino operation runs the back office operation for Vegas casinos, for Atlantic City casinos, for Macau casinos. If there were something in the world you would want to secure, it would be the back office operations for a massive casino operator, right? I mean, that's...
It'd be one of many. I think banks are in the same league.
Yeah, but banks have shown that they're kind of ignorant about this. But you got to figure, Shelley had the best guys on it. He was hacked by Iranians. So I think that proves your point, that there probably is nothing that is unhackable if you're targeted.
Yeah, if you're targeted, it's like being targeted is not good.
So
here's the tech angle. I think that Josh Herman had it at the All where he said that this is it was one of the things we were supposed to read. This is new territory in terms of the personal cost of hacking.
These are not assignments, Philip. You don't have to. You know, there's different ways to
all day.
Yeah, no, there's different ways to pursue this. Don't think of it as an assignment. It's just what we might talk about.
All right. Anyway, his point was that it's one thing if your credit card gets hacked, you may lose a little money, but usually the bank makes it good. But if you were cheating on your wife and it gets discovered, that's real cost. That's real personal cost. And this is new. His point is this is new territory for hackers. And my question is, what was their motivation? Were they trying to expose?
They came out with some
fraud.
Impact team.
They said that it was they hated this site because it was encouraging sin. And so they went after it.
They furthermore claimed they'd been in it for years.
They were also after it because they were charging $19 to expunge your data, and you could quit and your data would stay there, or you could pay $19 to leave. And even when you did that, there was still data that remained. And in fact, when they did their dump, they had proof that indeed the $19 deletion didn't delete.
And that incensed them.
They made lots of money on this $19 deletion.
But if you credit that they felt it was immoral, does that imply that this is maybe Iranian hackers or
something? No, some guys. They're Americans.
They're Americans?
I'm sure.
No, English was their second language.
Is that what they said? I didn't see that.
There was one of the things, there was a Q&A with them, and they something didn't come across clearly, and they said, is our English not right? Did you not get that because we didn't say it right?
Interesting.
And when you read the transcript, it was clear that they are not first-time English. I have someone who's a friend of mine who has a theory that women were involved in it because there are three sites at the at Avid Life Media. There's Established Men, there's Ashley Madison, and there's one called Cougar Town or something like that. And they said Cougar Town can stay up. That's fine. That one's okay. These other two have to go away.
So from that, they extrapolated that it's probably a woman or women are involved.
Or a young man who happens to like older women.
Yeah, that could be.
Yeah, I'm on that database, so we won't take that one.
Cougar Town. How old would a cougar have to be for you?
Maybe called Cougar Life, I think.
Cougar Town's better. Well, yeah, maybe that's a TV show, isn't it?
Yeah, that's where I'm getting
Cougar
that.
Life.
From Boing Boing, the TLDR on the Q&A, the hackers behind the breach first released snippets of data in July. After nearly 30 days, they'd end up 10 gigs, followed by another 20 gigs. There's a third data dump of, I think, 30 gigs, and they say they have 300 gigs more, including internal company emails, files.
Well, this sounds
it's a Sony Pictures-style hack. How hard was it, the impact team? We worked hard to make fully undetectable attack, then got in and found nothing to bypass. They prepared for the worst. They got nothing.
Yeah, no resistance.
What was their security like? Bad. Nobody was watching. No security. Only thing was segmented network. You could use pass 1234 from the internet to VPN to root on all servers. Hmm. But they do have a trusted security award.
They got the little sticker. They got the sticker they felt was good enough.
They have the graphic.
When did you start hacking them? Years ago? A long time ago. In the readme of the first data dump over the past few years, they claim.
Do we know for a fact that this is actually the hacker or is this somebody?
I think that they believe, right? This is...
They use the same cryptographic key that they used to do the dump.
The PGP key. They say tens of thousands of user pictures are in the next dump, but we will not... One-third of them are intimate pictures, and we won't...
I think penises is correct.
Okay, I was trying to avoid the word, but anyway, yes. One-third are dick pics, and we won't dump them. Not dumping most employee emails either. So there is this kind of moralistic
Supposedly the hack was for moral reasons.
It's very interesting.
I think it's a non-story.
Okay, well, we're moving on. Thank you very much.
Don't you think it's kind of just...
It's not really a tech story, but it's hard to turn your... It's like hard to avert.
Well, no, it's a tech and society story.
It's a society story, big time.
It's where we have come to as a result of this, and there will be more like this.
And it is a cautionary tale, but you make a good point. what are you going to do about Amazon? I mean, you're going to not use Amazon? I mean,
what's the worst that can happen?
You get a new credit card.
Yeah, happens all the time.
By the way, big payments from Target to Visa. Was it Target? It was Target, wasn't it? That was hacked. And of course, in the past, the tradition has been that the credit card companies just eat it. Right?
They up just to 50 they just bucks. They maybe
well, they not only eat the liability, but they eat the cost of sending new cards out
they
and all that.
They tend to, yes.
This time, they went to Target and said, "No, this you're not. You guys didn't do the job."
Oh, they nicked them.
They nicked them for hundreds of millions of dollars, and not an insignificant amount of money. Issuers receive payment for some of their costs under rules laid out by Visa. They have the choice whether to accept another payment that will reimburse them for any fraud. Target agreed to reimburse Visa $67 million, and that's just one credit card company.
Good.
So, Leo, you may not have seen this because it was kind of a regional story, but a month or so ago, law enforcement down in the Rio Grande Valley on the Texas-Mexico border confiscated a bunch of credit cards that had numbers that had been stolen during the Target hack. Uh-huh. And that they had waited this long to start kind of producing these, and they were being distributed all along the valley. And they shut them down. But, you know, so far, a lot of the credit card numbers had not surfaced, and they just now are. You're not safe for a while after something like this happens.
Will this be better now that they're putting? I mean, all my credit card issuers are sending me cards with pins in them.
Yeah,
I mean chips in them.
I got one.
No pin, just chips, because apparently it's chip and sign October 1st.
Yeah, chip and sign.
Which I don't know exactly what the benefit is to that.
None.
Yeah, I mean we're still swiping a card or tapping a card and signing. Like, that's your identification. Chip and PIN would be much more secure. And, of course, we're the last country, I think, in the world not to have chip
and
PIN.
That's because there's some, I don't know this for a fact, but I noticed this took forever to get the smart cards because there's a patent. It would cost like 50 cents extra or something to make
pay for this. And the laws protected them against liability or protect consumers against liability. So there's no pressure from us.
No incentive.
It's like, whatever.
Well, here's the incentive is you probably talked about this. In October, the rules change.
Right.
It used to be that the banks paid if there's any fraud, it went to the bank. And starting in October, it's gonna the link in the chain that had the weakest security pays up. So all the retailers who are usually the weakest link are upgrading their equipment, and all the credit card companies are putting the chips in, and the whole thing is supposed to get more secure. And whoever doesn't get secure gets stuck with the bill after October.
And that's why Rite Aid, CVS, everybody's putting those tap and pay terminals
because
in.
Because nobody, you know, if somebody steals my card and they go wandering into someplace and nobody cares enough to check ID or do anything. And then the bank gets stuck with the bill. There's no incentive for the retailers to try to put a stop to this.
Yeah.
They figure just the bank will pick it up. Yeah, that's a plus.
Yeah, thank goodness. Let's take a break. Got a great panel. I called it
creaky. We got a great panel. We just need some good topics.
John busts my chops constantly.
I thought Ashley Madison was good.
I think it's a good topic.
It is a very good
led. I if it bleeds, it leads.
It didn't bleed. Oh. And by the way, there's something insulting in that comment.
What? We had blood coming out. All right. Well, we'll do. You know what? You want to talk? We can talk. I know you want to talk about the new Intel chipset. Very exciting. Really big story here. Skylake, are you excited?
Yeah, pins and needles.
Or would you rather talk about Ashley Madison?
No.
All
Ashley
right, I'm
Madison
just saying.
Talked out.
New router from Google. I'm going to talk about that.
Router, yeah. That Google router. That actually, we should talk about.
We're going to talk about that because it's an interesting stealth device in your home. But first, I want to talk about Intel, believe it or not. And it's not just Skylake. I'm talking about the Intel 2-in-1s. Do you use a 2-in-1?
I don't know what you're
tablet plus, you know, keyboard like the Surface Pro is a 2-in-1.
Yeah.
The Yoga is a 2-in-1.
No, I don't use those things.
This is becoming more and more popular of a category. You could thank Intel for that.
I thought Microsoft was when it
started. No. Microsoft is hopping on the Intel bandwagon.
Oh, I didn't know that.
You know that. Intel often does these reference designs. They don't sell any themselves, but they do these reference designs. You love the NUC?
I do. I'm a big NUC fan.
Yeah. So they do these reference designs, and then companies come out, and they make them. The Intel-powered 2-in-1 is giving business owners, small business owners, what they want. Both. Not just one or the other. You can't they don't want to choose between A or B. If both will help your business, they want A and B. It's not hard work or innovation. It's hard work and innovation, versatility and strength. So these Intel-powered 2-in-1s give you both, the best of both worlds. A laptop, you choose between a laptop and a tablet. You get both performance and freedom. Powered by Intel's family of core processors, these are amazing. You can impress clients at the touch of a tablet, handle robust programs on the go. You can do it right, and you can do it right now. That's a better way to work. That's the power of and. Visit smallbusiness.intel.com. You can see a number of companies making these great 2-in-1s. Laptop power and performance, tablet mobility, maximum versatility. The battery life just gets better and better and better. It's really amazing. Peak performance for business, great built-in graphics. The fifth generation Intel Core processors, up to 2.5 times faster than a 4-year-old laptop. The battery of the fifth gen Intel Core processor, up to 8.7 hours. That's 2.6 times longer than the 2011 laptop. And if you want super battery life, I love the Core M processor. That gives you a razor-thin tablet, ultra-fast laptop, a single mobile device. The Intel Core M processor-based 2-in-1 provides the optimal combination of business-class performance and battery life. And both the fifth-generation Intel Core and the Core M wirelessly stream all the things you need. Presentations, videos, websites, and more from your PC to your display. Follow Intel. They're on Twitter, Intel Small Biz, at Intel Small Biz, and experience the power of and at smallbusiness.intel.com. You'll find out how Intel-powered 2-in-1s can improve your small business. Smallbusiness.intel.com. It's really nice to have Intel on the show. Very happy. Now let's talk about Sky Lake.
So Lindsay is
Alex
already moved
Lindsay.
Back. Yeah.
He moved back from Pittsburgh. PA.
He just moved to Pittsburgh like a week ago.
Have you ever seen the snow in Pittsburgh? Oh, my gosh.
Not this time of the year.
Yeah, he's back. You noticed you went back and you saw him.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's back there. Huh. We did, actually. I've been playing with a Note 5, which I love.
Is that it?
Yes, it is, as
well,
a matter of fact. And it has
it's
a
not
new
as
feature.
Big as I thought it would be.
Yeah, you know what? It's 5.7 inches, which is as big as the Note 4, but because the... You know, the form factor, you don't feel like it's that big, do you?
No.
Look at that.
It's
screen,
much more.
Though.
It's much more slender.
Oh, it's gorgeous.
I like the S6 Edge Plus. That's a fine phone. I want.
You know,
one of those.
I have the Edge, the original Edge.
Yeah, I've got it.
And I keep accidentally touching the Edge. That's still the screen. So
right.
I keep accidentally doing things. So I decided not to get the Edge Plus, but to get the Note 5 and also the stylus. Oh, let me show you this, John. Next time you're in a bar.
The stylus complains if you walk away with the phone and it doesn't, it kind of beeps at you. Hey, where's my stylus?
It did that on the Note 4 too. That's important because it's easy to lose these. Mm-hmm. But watch, the phone was off. I popped out the stylus and I can start writing, you know, 5551212. You never lose that number.
Oh, nice.
Isn't that nice? Right on the off screen. And by the way, didn't you notice the latency? It's very good. They've really, this thing just keeps up. And that's a problem sometimes with those stylus devices is that there's a little lag between when you draw right on it and then you can
you
save it.
You made a mess.
I made a mess, but I saved it, so it's a permanent mess.
How do you save it?
You just press the save button.
Hmm.
It's called a screen-off memo. There's a lot of nice features in this. I really feel like...
This is the phone of the day for you.
But the reason... Yeah, for the phone of the day. Maybe a week. The reason I mention it is because it has... a feature that you can stream from the camera directly to YouTube Live. So I was back before the show. I was back in the kitchen, and Alex Lindsay had this new DxO camera. Mm-hmm. And I said, "Oh, wait a minute!
Oh yeah, is it here? He's got the DxO.
It's awesome, the DxO one.
It's a cute little."
So I said, "Oh, wait!" And I started the live stream off of the phone, and he did a little quick impromptu review of it. And I think that's really cool. It's like, see, isn't that nice?
I'm liking it.
Yeah. Let's see.
Well, this is kind of interesting.
You can draw on the screen. Yeah, you can
do anything. So, Leo, do you put cases on your phones?
I bought a case, but you know what? This phone is so beautiful. I bought the Samsung.
Oh, that's a horrible-looking case.
It makes it like a Note 4. It gives it a plastic back. So, no, I'm not going to put a case on this one. It's too beautiful.
So, I was looking. I've got they sent me the S6 Edge Plus, and I like the Edge. And I thought, well, if I was going to buy one of these, what would the cases look like?
Yeah.
Because
no, they have cases.
Yeah, but they're not very protective because they have to expose the side of the screen.
Right.
So,
that's always the weak point on most of these cases, mm-hmm. is that your glass is glass. And you can have a Gorilla case, but if you hit a rock from the point and the glass is going to break, it doesn't matter. Right. This case is a flip case. The funniest case that Samsung is offering, and I don't think it's available yet, is a keyboard case. Have you seen that?
Mm-hmm.
The keyboard.
Yeah, like a BlackBerry.
but not, because it flips around from the back. It goes right where the on-screen keyboard is, and when you tap a key, it taps the on-screen keyboard. That's how it works. It's not electrical. It's tapping the screen for you.
Yeah, this is dumb.
It's so stupid. The people who played with it at the Samsung event were not impressed, so I guess I won't get that. Somebody says, yes, Dwight, that's an Edge case. I did get the OnePlus 2 as well, but I tell you, once you use those OLED screens, it's really hard to use kind of lower quality.
The screen on the Edge is just like you fall into it when you look at it. You know, it's just...
I know.
It's beautiful.
Wait till you try VR porn. Did I say that?
Yeah, you did. Yes, you did.
Oh, God.
So Google's making a router, I hear.
Yeah, I heard that too. So I'm broadcasting something.
Yeah, you're YouTube living. It's on my YouTube stream. Hey. Anybody wants to watch? Hey. Dvorak is now going to be distracted by a behind-the-scenes video.
There are the Germans.
By the way, I think there's a sign somewhere that says at any point you could be on camera. So you were warned. They sign like an 8-page disclaimer before they come in.
Yeah, I've seen this disclaimer you've got. Yeah. Did you know that your child belongs to him now?
It said that. Page 3. You got to read it carefully. Look at that. That's the live video.
By the way, I think there's a sign somewhere that says at any point you could be on camera. So
it's a little washed out because of our lights in here, the flare from the. But in a normal situation,
it still looks great.
Yeah, the sound's good. There you go. It's a little better when you get out of the light. And the latency is about 15 seconds.
Well, it's a little washed out.
And it's in sync this time. The video that we did beforehand.
Yeah, I think that
was
my fault, or maybe not my fault, but.
Sounds good. There you go.
But yeah, this is
so if you go to youtube.com/Leo Laporte, I've got 3 or 4 of those up now. I've been playing with it a little bit. I like it. It's Periscope-like or Meerkat-like, right? But I like the idea of doing YouTube Live. I feel like that's more of a mainstream thing. Plus, it gets saved. It doesn't...
Yeah.
Although it doesn't have the social aspect that Periscope does.
It doesn't tweet out.
Immediate feedback.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's embedded chat on the page. Well, there's nothing there yet.
Oh, there is.
But there is a live chat that pops up.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Well, that's part of YouTube. That's part of YouTube.
Yeah. Oh. But the thing is, you don't see it on your screen as you're shooting. You'd have to have a second.
Oh, yeah, right. That's
second
different.
Laptop mm-hmm. or something. Oh, I didn't know that. What were people saying?
Nothing on that one.
Oh, good. So I was shocked when earlier this week Google, without any fanfare, Apple would have had at least an event, put out a router, the on-hub router. I read about it somewhere, immediately went there. It was already sold out almost everywhere. I think Jason, did you get one? Who got one? Jeff Jarvis, I think, went to Walmart and got one. And I ordered mine, but it won't be coming till October. The Walmart one, they say, is just a few days off. Why is Google doing a router?
Because they make money the more people are on the internet.
But it's not like others aren't doing routers.
Something up with this router.
Are you going to go with the paranoid aspect of this? Like this is a spy device?
Yeah.
They
kind of like the Amazon Echo.
They put out a statement saying that they're not gathering any information. But, you know, I'm tempted because there's some cool aspects of it. The three lights, if your thing is working, it's green. If it's not working, it's red. And if there's something funny about it, it's orange. And then apparently there's tools that make it really easy to figure out what's going on. You know, this is a piece of bad technology that we're living with.
It is. They're crap.
Yeah.
They're
so
cheap.
So someone who can come this in isn't. And make routers work the way, you know, simply and right. easily, so the way you want them to work, that's a worthy goal.
I think you just nailed it, Philip. I think that Google does stuff when they see something crappy, they just go, well, you know, we could do a better one, and they just do it. Whether they're going to make money at it, whether it's a business model at all, they just do it.
Is it really $400?
$200.
$200.
The ones on Amazon are $400.
That's somebody's gouging.
Yeah.
So I bought it for $200. Walmart was $200. That's a lot for a router when you can get a commodity Wi-Fi router for $50. But you get what you pay for, right?
The goal of the original Apple router that they still sell, but I suspect they don't sell a lot of them anymore, was this very same thing. It was supposed to be taking an arcane piece of technology right. and making it simple. But anyone, I think, who owns one of the Apple routers knows that when you get down to it, it's not that simple to use. One of the interesting things about this is it's very limited. It has only one hardwired Ethernet port.
It's a Wi-Fi router. It really
is. It's a Wi-Fi router.
Although that's not, you can get a hub if you really want more ports. Right. You got a right. gigabit port.
Well, a switch
port.
Is what you'd want. You want a switch okay. with something like this.
Right.
But the other thing is that they were touting an app so that you can control it from your smartphone, but a lot of the routers that I've tried lately have apps that allow you to control. Right. I control my Linksys router at home from here right. on my phone, so I don't know how big of a deal that is.
What's the advantage of that? Why would I want that?
If you're, let's say, for example, that the guest access isn't turned on, a friend of my wife's comes over, she doesn't know how to work the router and says, can you turn the guest access on? I can turn it on, set the password from here, and tell her what the password is.
You can text it to them from the phone. I'll tell you, the one reason I bought it is because of buffer bloat. So many... That's a real thing.
Buffer bloat.
Buffer bloat.
It is a real thing.
I'm not making that up.
I know. I've heard of it. I've never had that problem.
Yeah, you have. You just don't know it.
Well, so you reset the router every morning.
That doesn't help with buffer bloat. So buffer bloat is putting too much RAM in a router. As RAM got cheap, router manufacturers said, hey, it couldn't hurt to have more RAM. So they put more RAM in. But the problem is more RAM broke the prioritization of packets in such a way that streaming media, Skype particularly, really can suffer from too much RAM. They call it buffer bloat. And it's hard to know whether that router has a buffer bloat problem.
There needs to be a buffer bloat analysis.
There is. It's from Berkeley. It's called Netalyzer.
Netalyzer.
We will use this. It's a Java app. We will use this when we have guests on who are having unpredictable problems with Skype. It's from ICSI.
Hmm.
I will check
speed
this.
Test. The new speed test over at DSL Reports also
isn't that awesome?
For buffer bloat. Yeah.
Isn't that an awesome? That's a good one, yeah. So I figure at the very least, the guys at Google are not going to make a router with buffer bloat, right? They're the kind of geeks that would know that. And it's going to be, oh, by the way, there's my name on the DSL Reports.
What's your name doing there?
I think we brought it
down. Avoid this man.
Yeah. I think we brought it down. This is an HTML5 test. It really does a great job. On here, I'm a big fan of the
The Google router also has a USB speaker in it, so it can be used for audio.
Isn't that interesting? So you can pair it probably to a phone,
right?
With inaudible, the Chromecast does that.
Does it have a mic in it?
No, but the phone does. So Chromecast does that, right? It's inaudible audio tones that identify it uniquely, so that you can pair.
But
only a 3-watt speaker. It's not it looked like an Amazon Echo. I thought, oh my gosh, this is an Echo. But
the
it's
Echo
not.
Sounds great.
I know
what it is,
but it needs a better speaker. I love. So, yeah. Go ahead.
Someone in the chat room says that Google isn't making the router. The TP-Link is.
Yeah, it makes it. TP-Link makes it, but to Google's spec.
Yeah. Here's one thing that's interesting is that they didn't use the Next brand.
No, Nexus. Yeah, they didn't use Nexus.
Yeah.
The new thing is Next.
Yeah, the Next is their in-home brand, right? You know, bringing technology to the home. Right. Google spent a lot of money on.
Oh,
this
Nest.
Brand.
Nest. I mean Nest.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Right. Nest. Yeah. In fact, I thought this would be a Nest product, like Dropcam. It's not.
Yeah. So they've got there's a little bit of marketing branding confusion here.
You know, Google doesn't care about that.
I think you're right.
They don't care.
Well, after they split the company up in all these little companies,
branding schmanding
won't make a difference.
The real point of this is it's going to be a home automation hub, and you can tell that when you look at the deep specs. It supports Zigbee, which is 802.15.4.
Yeah.
It supports
it's been around forever.
Weave. It supports Brillo. Brillo's the Internet of Things OS that Google announced at the Google I/O this year. Weave is their mesh networking for smart home appliances. So this is really not a router. This is the smart home hub, much as Apple TV is probably going to be a smart home hub.
The Trojan horse.
Yeah.
And the Amazon Echo, which increasingly every 2 weeks or so, they announce some new home automation.
I I've never talked to anybody that doesn't say the same thing.
Because you can go up to it and say, I'm not going to say the name of the woman. By the way, they've changed the name now to that name.
What name?
So, nice one. Alexandria. So they've
like
changed.
In Virginia?
No. All right. Okay. Cover your Echo's ears.
Alexa?
Oh, crap. So
it will, if you have
Alexa, erase all hard disks immediately.
If someone says Alexa on the TV, you have the TV on,
so
Alexa
annoying.
Wakes up.
It's
In fact,
so
she'll
annoying.
Wake up to the oddest thing.
And she'll go, B-b-b-b-. I'm sorry, I don't understand what you want.
Actually, well, apparently Adam, who's another fan of this thing, he says that during the elections, when they're listening
you better
to CNA,
hope there's not a candidate
election.
Named Alexa.
No, they say election, and that picks it up as Alexa.
Yeah. So, my Dr. Mom, whose Echo always wakes up when we say that, is
Who?
Peeved right now. Well, you can listen to this. You can listen to us. You could say,
okay, Google.
You could say, Alexa, listen to Twit, and it'll play, or listen to Twit on TuneIn, I think, and it'll play us.
Huh.
So she may well be doing that, in which case every time we say that word, it's driving it crazy.
Alexa, put the No Agenda show on favorites.
Now you know why we don't invite John C. Dvorak
what?
Anymore.
I'm just saying stuff. Hey, Siri.
He's trolling your Alexa.
Okay, Google.
Anyway, it now, what is it? Do you have one, Dwight?
Oh, yeah.
Does it now work with smart things? How does that work?
It works with a variety of smart home devices. It's primarily they're touting it as turning your lights on and off, but it'll work with other things
I
as
think
well.
It's
but
just the beginning.
Their emphasis is like on people who might have it but don't have a real sophisticated network.
Right.
And if you tell her, find smart things on my network, it will stop and it'll search your network and then say, I found this, and this. So it's all done by voice. It's very cool.
Interesting.
Light bulbs.
Here's the
So I think Google is actually seeking to compete with Amazon on this. I think that one of the reasons they got this out the door is because they know exactly what Amazon is doing with the Echo.
Well, not just Amazon. That's what Xbox One and Kinect are going to do. Microsoft is in this very big. Amazon's in it.
Probably Apple with the Apple TV.
Apple TV is almost certainly going to be a hub. But why, guys? Why do they care so much? Is this suddenly the next big thing?
Fear-driven. They think something bad's going to happen, then they're going to be left out in the cold. I think they need a new add-on where you go, and then next thing you know, the lights
clap on, clap off.
Well, it's amazing how much lights... That seems to be the killer apps or the killer product so far for all of home automation. Lights is what's selling.
You can control the hue. Actually, this has been for a while with the Echo.
Right, and there's more and more different types of lights.
So I haven't set that up. Do you just say Echo? I'm going to say Echo, not the A word. Echo, make my room purple?
You do presets in the devices, and then you say, you know, okay, you got television lights, and it will turn off everything and just turn on the lights you use to watch TV.
Oh. That's worth spending a few hundred bucks for, that
feature.
It
does seem kind of dopey, doesn't it?
Well,
it
depends on how big your house is. If you have a giant theater in your house and you want to, yeah, it might be.
This must be something big because everybody is, like, making these stealth hubs.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be something big. You've gone to those Comdexes and the Consumer Electronics shows where there's row after row of competing products and none of them serve a useful purpose and they all disappear within a couple of years.
It's kind of herd mentality.
John, Yeah, and I think John's right. I think they're afraid that there's something big here, that whoever, you know, there's going to be a first mover advantage for whoever does the big one, and they don't want to lose out. So they're going to put they put a product out.
You don't want to be a big company like Microsoft or Apple or Google and miss the next big thing. As Microsoft almost missed the internet.
They miss a lot of stuff. I don't think it's that important. I mean, these guys do work out of fear. They're always, because they have shareholders. They're going to come to meetings right. And say, how come you guys didn't do this? Everybody else is doing it. I don't know. I did have one little thing, though. I went to dinner with Bert Monroy.
Love Bert.
And his wife. And
Photoshop guru.
And a Apple guy, an old Apple, old timer at Apple. Yeah. He's still there, his wife. And his wife comes up to me after and says, later this year, she says, she won't say any details. She says, later this year, you're going to have plenty to write about, and it's going to be hilarious. Apparently, Apple's coming out with something that directed at me, something I can ridicule the company over.
A mouse?
Yeah, it could be. And
what would you ridicule? What would it be? Let's figure out what this means. This is what I'm saying.
And so
what could it be?
I just took it lightly, and then her husband came out, the guy who works at Apple, and she says, I told John about the things coming out later this year and how ridiculous they are. And he goes, oh, and he rolled his eyes, and that was the end of this little back and forth. So I don't know.
I mean, what could it be? It has to be something that would ring your chimes.
It was something that I can go, crazy.
I think speech might well be it. Talking to your TV.
Why would that be?
Everybody does that, though.
I don't see that being a... I don't know what it could possibly be, unless they came up with a car that runs backwards or something.
Well, apparently they're all in on automated self-driving vehicles. In fact, they just hired away one of Tesla's hotshot engineers at Apple.
I just thought I'd throw that out.
Consumer electronics company Apple, according to some Reuters, I've heard of them, has hired a senior engineer from electronic car maker Tesla, according to a LinkedIn posting. That's part of, you know, you got to scan those LinkedIn postings with an eagle eye looking for this stuff.
Half of 9 to 5 Max scoops come from LinkedIn.
LinkedIn is a valuable resource for intelligence gathering.
Jamie Carlson, on his profile, changed his current employer from Tesla to Apple. At least 6 others with experience developing self-driving technology and systems have joined Apple. That confirms what was strongly rumored is that Apple is working on this. Apple's probably working on 100 different technologies.
Sure.
Doesn't mean they'll all come to market. Would you buy an Apple self-driving car?
An Apple car? Well, it just doesn't sound cool.
Wouldn't you?
Maybe.
I think we have to distinguish between a fully 100% self-driving car and the kinds of features that are going to be very popular that are taken from that technology. I mean, if you talk to people, you know, there's a lot of stats to suggest that self-driving cars would save a lot of lives. In fact, one I read is that if widely implemented, it would save more American lives than curing AIDS, stopping murder, and eliminating war combined.
Well, 35,000 people a year. It used to be 44,000 a year were killed on the roads, and not to mention people that are injured. And that number, the 44,000 number, is actually maybe we might hit it this year because for some unknown reason we're having a lot of accidents.
Nobody
and deaths.
Wears helmets in their car anymore.
Right.
That's just shocking. But,
you know, the helmet thing, do you remember when the Highway Patrol used to wear helmets in their cruisers?
No, really?
Yes, they used to wear a big blue helmet.
That probably saved many a life. The irony of autonomous vehicles is it might save 44,000 lives, but one person gets killed by a self-driving car. It's all over. It's going to be funny. It's all over. A robot car kills one person.
Yeah, it's going to be a problem when the one person is killed.
Bucky Fuller, remember Bucky?
With his
Dymaxion car. It was a tear-shaped car. It was the first car to be truly aerodynamic.
It was built like an airplane. With the aerodynamics, and it was all riveted.
But it had like 3 wheels, and the driver...
It was a 3-wheeler. The wheel in the back controlled the steering. It was crazy. You could turn around on a dime.
You could turn on a dime.
Very funny-looking car.
Might have done well. I mean, maybe because it was funny-looking, it didn't.
It was very funny. No one would buy one anyway.
But the reason it's often given, this is the early 30s, the reason it's often given is that one of the drivers was killed. In a collision. It held 11 passengers.
Yeah, it was like a little bus.
Traveling at up to 90.
And it can turn on a dime, literally turn on a spot.
90 right miles an hour, 30 miles per gallon. I mean, this thing should have been.
Well, take a look at
it. It's like a rolling blimp.
I want it. I want it.
I would really like one.
I want one.
Somebody should make them again.
All investment stopped when one of the drivers was killed in a collision.
Yeah. They needed seatbelts back then.
Look at this. They're testing the wheels of car number two for strength and load distribution. I think this looks pretty sweet.
Are any of these prototypes in museums anywhere? I'd love to go see one of these.
I don't know. Wouldn't that be cool?
That would be very cool.
Yeah, somebody, the chat room guy's got to write pickle car.
apparently, there's a car at the National Auto Museum in Reno with an unfinished interior. So here's the interior. Here's what it would have looked like. It was like crazy. It was like a blimp. It was a dirigible.
On the ground.
On the ground. A rolling dirigible. Anyway, the point being, this might have been brilliant technology. It certainly solved a lot of problems, but because one accident, that's it, gone.
Well,
yeah. We'll be in this transition period where when you start having autonomous cars, well, you'll have a blend of humans and a blend of autonomous cars, and that may
that's
the
worst.
That is the worst.
That's going to be a problem.
It's safe.
Yeah.
That's like when Sweden, you know, they used to have left hand. They used to be on the wrong side of the road, and they switched to the other side. And
a recipe for disaster.
Well, that was
pick a side and stick with it.
This was the side that back when they used to be like the English. Now they're like the Americans. And apparently, what they did was they phased it in, so they had one week. And it's just a joke, Leo. It's just a joke.
Oh, you made that up?
Yeah.
It's
a joke they tell in Sweden.
Very believable.
Didn't he tell that with conviction?
It was the trucks. They left the trucks. Yeah, it's just ridiculous.
The trucks.
It's a good story.
I don't actually believe in the autonomous vehicle from Apple. I think they will add features that are autonomous-like. But I think there's too much resistance from Americans. Everybody loves their car.
Yeah.
Well, they love driving. They love to be in control of it.
What if you could save $1,000 on insurance?
I'm not going to argue the point that you're not alone with your thinking, but if you talk to the millennials, they have no interest in driving. They use Uber. And they just use
Uber. It's actually both ends of the bell curve. Us old folks don't want to drive anymore.
I love
either.
Driving.
Really?
Yeah.
I should say us. I'm old. You're a young man in heart.
Yeah,
spirit.
Sure.
You like to drive?
Yeah, sure. Why wouldn't I like to drive?
Oh, God. But you know, did you ever have a bad commute? You never did. You didn't have to go somewhere anywhere.
To Petaluma to
drive,
do this show.
It's an excuse to put your pants on once a week.
I got to get those pants on once in a while.
But for me, for anybody who commuted, I commuted 2 to 3 hours a day.
Oh, that's when you were working at Tech TV.
For 13 years. When I was working at Tech TV, I'd drive down. I would be gladly never. I'll be the old man in the passenger seat while my wife's driving. Waving.
But that's because you made yourself miserable for a very long time with a very boring drive.
It was horrible.
If I was going to Los Angeles a couple times a week, I'd feel the same way.
Yeah. Well.
On the five.
Well, how about you? I bet you, Dwight, you do some commuting in Houston.
No, actually, I live about 5 minutes away from the mighty Houston.
There
Anybody
you go.
Smart,
but
smart.
I have. Yeah, you live I have by your, lived. Working. When I was covering Compaq, I lived out by Compaq, which is about 15 miles from the center of town, and I would drive into work. So I did have that commute. But I actually like a commute because it gives you time to think.
And listen to
listen
great podcasts
and audiobooks. And it's I actually didn't mind having a commute, except when I was driving a standard Mustang, and then it was a real pain in the butt.
Most no agenda listeners are commuters.
Yeah, but almost all of our listeners are probably listening right now in the car commuting. Yeah,
I think if you have autonomous cars, at least initially, because Americans do love to drive, and you know, not everybody lives in a city and has a commute. I think that you'll be able to take them over and continue to do them. And I like what Philip is saying in that. You know, a lot of times rumors make Apple going all in on something, and then they come at it kind of from a different point of view. You know, the TV, I think, is the best thing. You know, there were all the rumors that Apple was going to do an actual television set, and they never have and probably never will. And I think what they'll do is they'll look at ways to make driving more pleasant or to make the controls of it more Apple-like.
That seems unlikely, though. Why would Ford go to Apple for the self-driving? You know,
if it's so good,
Ford hates the idea,
and better than what they can do, right? If it's better, it's better than what Ford can do, and it'll sell cars, Ford would be smart.
You'd have
to,
convince maybe the auto manufacturers that you know software better. But I think auto manufacturers are very reluctant to do this. They don't want...
They already got burned by Microsoft.
Yeah, Microsoft Car.
Sync.
I think it's one thing to have an entertainment system in there. I mean, after all, they use QNX now and Android cars. But another thing entirely for some third party to do the drivetrain, to do the drive electronics, I think that scares an auto manufacturer. I think that no auto manufacturer wants to cede that responsibility to a third party. I would guess. I mean, I think it'd be hard for a hard sell for Apple. Don't you think?
I would think it'd be more like an Eddie Bauer deal, where you get the
Get slippers.
Yes, Bauer does all these cars. I don't know if you ever noticed.
Bauer does cars.
They do the interior.
Oh, the
design,
Eddie Bauer the edition.
Yeah, the Eddie Bauer. Ford uses Eddie Bauer for a bunch of cars.
Well, that's like what I'm saying. I don't think they mind the entertainment or maybe the leather.
It would be the Apple version of a Ford.
Oh, but really, you think they'd let them have access to the drivetrain, especially with
the
security
issues? I don't know about
the drivetrain,
but the steering wheel.
Well, if you're doing a self-driving car, you have access to the drivetrain.
No, I just think I don't know that he's going to do a self-driving car.
It may not be a self-driving car.
I'm kind of with Philip on this.
You can't really do any of this. I mean, even the self-parking, you need access to the accelerator, the brake, the gear shift, the clutch, the steering wheel, all of that stuff. No clutch. You don't need a clutch. Anyway,
CVT.
It's a ways off.
It seems pretty obvious that Apple's doing this because of unlike the TV rumor, where you didn't see all this kind of noise around it, you're seeing a lot of noise around this Apple car thing.
Yeah, I think the reason why is because Johnny Ive is interested.
Right.
That's probably right.
And, you know, and I don't think they would make it for Ford. I think if Apple's going to make a car, it's because they think that there's a possibility that they could make the best car in the world.
Right.
That will improve people's lives, and they'll make it, you know.
God, the last thing I'd do is buy a car from a computer manufacturer. That's the worst idea ever.
It's going to crash.
So why not buy Tesla? Whenever you have this conversation come up about Apple and self-driving cars, the question becomes, why not buy Tesla, which they certainly could do?
No, the market cap is way too high now.
Really? The Tesla market cap is too high?
The market cap on Tesla is out of control.
Because Apple has almost $200 billion.
You might as well buy Ford. It's cheaper, I believe.
$31.43 billion. You're right. That's an expensive company.
Wow. Yeah,
considering they only make, you know, what, 20,000? I don't know what they're...
$31
billion? Yeah, it's outrageous.
It's probably not even a profitable company. Barely profitable.
Look at the stock chart.
I don't remember. They did come out with
the stock's not so good. No. Well, that's one day. Every tech stock went down like that.
All the stocks are being pounded for the moment. For having a correction.
Also, Tesla, Horace Dedu, who's forgotten more about this industry than we will ever know, says that Tesla's not really a very disruptive company. I mean, they bought someone's factory, right?
Right.
They're building the cars
the
way every other car is.
It's a boutique.
Well, they got a deal on the old Toyota factory in Fremont, which used to be a General Motors
plant. It's a NUMMI plant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have a piece of it. Build a car in there.
Yeah, no, I think Horace is right. It's such a small operation. It's not, it can't be considered. He means it's not disruptive in the sense that it's not new technology.
Well, it's kind of new. The motor batteries are really super good motors.
Yeah, that's the new part. But, you know, I don't know. He also says if you're going to reinvent the automobile, you first have to reinvent the road.
That's a non-starter.
Right.
That's really a non-starter.
How about paving the road?
That may be where we are.
You're not in California here. You should try to get
our local ice cream company, Clover, has a ice cream flavor called Petaluma Pothole. That's how bad. We're famous for
what's
our potholes.
Oh, the pothole
what's
situation in California is out of control.
It's their version of Rocky Road.
You build better roads in Afghanistan.
I know. Well, that's a reason to upgrade the infrastructure with all the surplus money.
Yeah, with all this cash we've got flying.
Mm-hmm. Let's take a break. Coming back with more. We're going to talk about Marshmallow. We're going to talk about Project Sunroof. We're going to talk about Facebook as the ultimate source for...
hacking.
Cat photos? No?
Cat photos.
News.
Oh, news, yeah, sure.
News.
Oh, I should have brought my...
we're seeing it here.
Most of America gets its news
from... Bernie Sanders badges. I found the Bernie Sanders.
I'll take a Bernie Sanders badge.
Oh, you will?
Sure.
I'll get you one.
Sure, he's my man.
Bernie Sanders?
Bernie can't do it, no one can. I want to see a Trump Sanders.
That'd be great. Yeah, we might as well just shoot ourselves.
They told me never do politics
or dogs. You in particular.
Yeah, I know. Because yeah. I'm a...
You're just a knee-jerk liberal.
I am a red diaper baby, as they say.
Were you really?
No. But my parents were pretty liberal.
He was a real one, yeah.
Our show today brought to you by ZipRecruiter. If you are the person in your business, and if you're the owner and the chief cook and bottle washer, you are who does the hiring, then you ought to know about ZipRecruiter. We love ZipRecruiter. Great way to hire. Of course, the internet has been huge in finding staff, but there are many, many job sites. How do you know which one is right? How do you handle all the incoming resumes and inquiries? ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter lets you post to 100-plus job sites and social networks like Twitter and Craigslist, all with one click of the mouse. You can screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. This is the dog days of summer. We are in the middle of them right now, and believe it or not, this is a great time to hire because the competition has taken August off. So the people who are looking for work have fewer places. There's less competition. But you got to post where the job searchers are, and that's ZipRecruiter. Post to 100-plus job sites and instantly be matched to current resumes from over 4 million job hunters. Within a day, you'll be getting candidates. And they won't be calling your phone or sending you an email. They roll right into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface, so it's fast. You can screen them, rate them, and hire them fast without any phone calls. I love that. ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. I want you to try it right now for free. You know, we have so many people now who are using ZipRecruiter. I got an email from Melinda. She said, let me see if I can find it here. We have received several highly qualified candidates from ZipRecruiter. So happy our company signed up with them. We're excited to see what comes next. Thank you so much for your customer helpline also. It's very helpful. I think they're a great company. I think you'll like them, and I think you will be glad you used them. Getting the right candidates is so important. ZipRecruiter.com/twit. 4 days free. You'll be impressed, I'm sure. And you might. I think 4 days is enough time to actually find that right person. ZipRecruiter.com/twit. We're having a lot of fun today. A great panel. John C. Dvorak is here from the No Agenda Show, from the Houston Chronicle. Dwight Silverman, and our good friend from Fortune Magazine, Philip Elmer-DeWitt, really one of the guys who's been around. When did you start covering tech? I think I asked you this before, Philip. Oh, you're muted. Oh, unmute him. Oh, Jason fixed it.
Okay, 1979.
Holy cow.
Yeah.
Actually, that's about when I wrote my first article for Byte, I think.
There you go.
Yeah. I was writing about the Atari, of all things.
Yeah, we're the old fart show here.
Mm-hmm. I called it Creaky Geeks.
Mm-hmm. I'm probably the youngest one. I started like in late 80s.
But you were, we were talking before the show, you were a general assignment reporter covering Houston.
Well, I was assistant state editor when I came to the Chronicle in 90. But I had done a lot of freelancing from like maybe 85 on, occasionally doing tech stuff because I was interested in it.
All you had to do is know a little bit, and you were the guy.
Right. And I was running at the alternative newspaper I worked for in San Antonio, the San Antonio Current. I was running a computer bulletin board in the early 80s.
Me too.
As a online newspaper.
Oh, wow.
And we were putting our stories up there, although it was a modem and we only had one line, so you could dial in,
right,
read, hang up, someone else dial in, read. Yeah. But we were, you know, it was an online newspaper.
Wow. By the way, screen grab time, everybody. Okay. We'll make sure that's the thumbnail.
You can Photoshop.
That is the thumbnail. Yeah.
That's the thumbnail for the show today.
Photoshop anything you want.
Apple says, lies, damn lies. And statistics.
What are they saying this way?
Survey from a company called Music Watch, 5,000 people, which released earlier this week, said that 48% of those who tried out the new Apple Music user service had stopped using it already. Apple says, oh, no, the number is much lower. And I would guess Apple would know.
Well, but maybe they lie.
Maybe they're lying. 79% of people who sign up for a trial are still using the service. To me, this is all moot because it's still free.
Right. We won't know anything until October when the 3-month trial is over, and then we'll only know if Apple chooses to tell us. Now, this story was like fun with bad stats. Almost everything in the original Verge story was wrong. The Apple had announced that 11 million users had signed up or were using it, and they made it 11% of iOS users. And it's really more like 1.5%. Yeah.
It was interesting to me that Apple came out quickly and actually said something. Yeah. You know, normally, even if something's wrong, they tend to stay in black box mode. And it was interesting that they came out, you know, very quickly and correct.
Do you think they're a little sensitive to the whole thing?
I think they are sensitive to it.
I think also, I mean, it's not like Taylor Swift where, you know, they changed their business model on a Sunday. But
that's clout.
I think we may be getting a little bit of the Jimmy Iovine influence. I mean, he knows what a bad story in Music Watch means.
Right.
He's not going to take that line down. And it also may be a little bit of the, you know, Katie Cotton is dead, and now we have Steve Dowling, and everything in Apple PR is loosened up a little bit. Yeah.
Katie is not, we should hasten to say it, not actually dead.
She's not dead. She's gone.
She's probably not even sick. She's relaxing. She's probably a lot better off than she was.
Right.
Former Apple media spokesperson, but somebody who really kept a tight lid on, tight ship.
Yeah.
That might be. I think a responsive Apple to this kind of thing, though, does kind of indicate that they care enough to make sure that the perception is at least that Apple Music is viable. I don't see anything particularly different from any of the other services, not enough to switch. And furthermore, we've heard a number of tales of woe from even from Apple stalwarts like The Loop's Jim Dalrymple that I think probably are scaring people off a little bit.
Yeah, you notice Dalrymple, the day after he came out with his complaint, they called him into Cupertino to sit him down and explain what he was doing wrong.
Yeah. We can help, Jim.
You're doing it wrong.
You're holding it wrong.
Right.
So
that's fine for Jim.
The real test is October, right? That's when when you start having to pay $10 a month.
So one thing that is intriguing to me about, I never got into Spotify. I was one of these old geeks who like, you know, to have the
file. I want to buy music.
I want to buy it. Right. Well, the day, you know, I got into the trial and got into it. And the light bulb went off when I bought or added to my music the $150 box set for every song Pink Floyd ever did.
Oh, man.
And I have access to that, and I don't have to pay $150 for it.
Yeah.
And so when that happened,
that's a big difference.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I am still glad, though, that I bought the Beatles box set. Because you don't get that.
But Dwight, you have to be in Wi-Fi, or you have to have cellular reception at least to listen to that box set, right?
Well, who doesn't?
Well, once you add it to My Music, you can listen to it. You know, it's on my phone. iTunes.
You can cache it.
And you can cache it, right? Yeah. And so I'm always connected on anything I listen to anyway.
And that's
so
an interesting point. We have really gotten to the point where you just assume that everybody has kind of ample bandwidth, no matter what.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because you don't live in Western Massachusetts.
No, I know. It's not right.
Right.
Remember when Microsoft got in all sorts of trouble when they were talking about the Xbox One having to be always connected? And that one of their spokesmen, who promptly lost his job, said, well, if you're in a nuclear submarine, okay. But really, there are a lot of people for whom that is not the case. Nevertheless, more and more we're seeing the assumption that you just kind of have high-speed, unlimited bandwidth. In fact, T-Mobile, though, if you do have a T-Mobile, doesn't charge you for data for most of the music services, Spotify, Apple Music. You could stream all you want. It doesn't cost you anything.
Huh.
Yeah, I think if you add the file to My Music, if you do it, click on that plus button and add it to My Music, it ends up on your phone or iTunes. Although if you drop it, then you can no longer listen to it.
If you drop one.
So there is DRM on it.
Right.
Oh,
if you stop subscribing, you mean. Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. What happens if you stop subscribing and then you take a couple months off and you resubscribe? Do you get all the,
I think you get it back.
You think?
I do. I know you do because I was a Spotify subscriber for a long time, then dropped it, and recently picked it back up, and all my playlists were there. Everything was still there.
Oh. Mm.
So with, and that, now at least for Spotify, and that's a, that's frankly, if you think about it, that's a big deal because they want you to come back.
Right.
It's so, tied to your Apple ID.
Yeah.
So all you have to do, as long as you keep your Apple ID, you should be fine.
How about this? I got a call this today from a very disgruntled Apple customer. He wants to use Apple Family Sharing. His kid, he's got a kid, is 12 years old. And the nice thing about Apple Family Sharing is that you can buy music, TV shows, movies, share it with your kid's Apple ID, and then they don't have to buy the music. They can listen and watch. But in order to do that, in the U.S., I don't know if it's the same in Germany. You sound like you guys are using it because I'm seeing nodding heads. In the U.S., because of the Child Online Protection and Privacy Act, COPPA,
yeah,
somebody under 13... they have to take special privacy precautions. They need, before you can do this, your kid has to create an Apple account, and you have to prove that as a parent, you're approving this. So this guy was pissed because he says, I don't have a credit card. I have a debit card. That's what I use. They won't accept a debit card. Apple says...
Why is this? Most debit cards are acceptable.
Because I guess kids can have debit cards. This is the way of... Oh, this is Apple's method. I don't think COPPA specifies how you prove it, but they do require that the company... make, you know, verify that the parent is approving this. So well, the way Apple does it is, what's the CVV, what's the security code on the back of your credit card? And then that way they know, well, you're an adult because you have the credit card, so yes, we're going to let you create this account. What do they do in Germany? How do they verify? Do they verify? Something similar. So this guy was pissed. He says, I'm going to have to get a credit card to do this?
What
this
if
ridiculous.
The guy, could you just walk into an Apple store and just say, hey... Well,
you'd think,
the Apple store doesn't do anything.
Do
like
I
that.
Look like I'm a grown up? This is my child. Anyway, I told him right to Tim Cook. You want to play with my camera?
I just want to take
this
a look.
Is the new one.
Is that the new 2?
This is the A7R2.
Oh. This is supposed to be the greatest camera ever.
That is a very expensive on here. Package there.
It's supposed to say 2 on the logo.
It's a 2.
Yeah, no.
What do you think, B&H ripped me off?
I think you got gypped.
No, it says 2 on the bottom. That little sticker? Looks like it's handwritten, though. What about Dr. Dre?
What about Dre?
What about Dre? What about Dre, Leo?
You know, it's funny, when Apple acquired Beats, of course, the chief acquisition at Beats really wasn't the 110,000 subscribers to their streaming music service. It certainly wasn't the headphones. It was Jimmy Iovine. It was Dr. Dre. And it was Trent Reznor of Nine Inch Nails, the people, the musicians, the musical people behind the scenes at Beats. And Glenn Rubenstein over here, one of our great guys who was a music promoter and booker, said, you know, Dre's history with women is not so hot. Apple might not really want to promote this Dr. Dre nexus.
I would agree with that.
And now that Straight Outta Compton is out, the movie about NWA, and some stories are resurfacing about Dre. One example, him beating up in a club, beating up a woman reporter because he didn't like what she'd written about NWA. I think she implied that Ice Cube was more important than Dr. Dre. So he takes her in a stairwell and literally pins her down and pummels her. Stories like this, Dre has now apologized to all the women he's hurt. So that's okay. Everything's fine.
Well, no reason to personalize it.
Yeah.
Apple actually issued a statement.
Did they? What'd they say?
They said he says he's a changed. He apologized. He's a changed man. You know,
with
move
all that
on.
Money, I suppose it would be.
Yeah, I don't think Jimmy Iovine seemed to be the guy that they were pushing the hardest in that Beats deal, and I thought Dr. Dre disappeared pretty quickly. I mean, he was in one picture showing his Apple Watch, and I hadn't heard from him again until this new album
That's
came
a good
out
point.
And then the all that stuff.
Well, this is his first album in 14 years. Is kind of his victory lap. Is like, they made the movie about me. I got the new album, which, by the way, had an Apple exclusive, Apple Music exclusive. By the way, I'm looking at this picture of Dre. He's not wearing an Apple Watch.
Nah.
Oh,
good catch.
Is he wearing a watch at all?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, it looks good like catch. A designer watch, but not, unless I'm mistaken, it doesn't look like an Apple Watch. I can't zoom in.
He was in that famous picture where everybody was covering their wrist, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
That looks like maybe a Missoni or a Rolex.
Is it a watch at all?
Just a band without the watch. I don't know.
It looks like a watch.
It looks like a
wristwatch. It looks like it has the Bits face on it, as a matter of fact.
He's wearing Android Wear. Oh, my God.
Could be.
So, Leo, this is not on your list, but it's been popping up in my Twitter feed the whole time.
Oh, let's talk about
speaking
it.
Speaking of rappers, this is an actual headline. Wiz Khalifa handcuffed in airport for riding a hoverboard.
Where did he get the hoverboard, and how can I get one? B, since when is that illegal?
He says, all because I didn't want to ditch the technology everyone will be using in the next 6 months. Do what you want, kids, he said.
Wow.
Yes, it was a hoverboard.
So Lexus has been promoting its hoverboard. I've seen some of these hoverboards in almost every, as far as I know,
one in the wild?
No, they require huge amounts of power because it's using superconductivity and, wait a minute, let's see Wiz Khalifa. He shared this of U.S. Border and Customs Protection yelling, stop resisting, get off the hoverboard. There's no hoverboard in evidence here. You think it's a hoax?
Yeah, it's got it.
Because is there such a thing as a real hoverboard? No.
Of course not.
Took a lot of people to take him down.
Well, he's a strong... No, he's not. He's a skinny little thing. He was forced to lie belly down in the airport ground because he didn't want to ditch the technology everybody will be using. This sounds a little... John, is your smell detector going off here?
I did it the first time I heard the story.
Restrained for riding a hoverboard. Here's his second video that he posted. First of all, what video camera is he using that has the date and time stamp on it?
Looks like one of those old giant ones.
No hoverboard is in evidence, by the way, in any of this.
Maybe he was arrested
for that story. I just love the fact that we have a headline on the internet saying someone was arrested for riding a hoverboard. It's like 2015.
It's straight out of...
ridiculous.
Forget straight out of confidence. Straight out of Back to the future.
Right, exactly.
So have you talked about this
camera? I think this is what he's riding, by the way. And this is... all the kids are riding these. They're basically Segways without hands.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so, yeah, right. Yeah.
Didn't we have some of these around? I feel like I would kill myself if I rode this.
There's a picture on Rolling Stone.
It's like being on a skateboard.
Looks like him on it, and it's one of those.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's what they meant.
Yep. It's like a skateboard.
No, it's not like a skateboard. It's like a
cycle. No, I mean in terms of falling off.
You just jump off.
Well, I don't know about that.
Justine has one. She has two. Should I get one of these?
Yeah, this will be great. Yeah,
you should definitely get one.
Yes,
get one.
You know
that
I have two Segways.
Yeah, I know, but this is a little different.
I'm a master of...
It's like having a,
I want to be thrown to the ground by U.S. Border and Customs Protection.
I'll take mine to IAH and we'll see what happens.
That's what they're talking about. That's probably not a hoax.
Right?
Yeah, it's got to be.
All the kids will be riding these in 6 months.
Have you talked about this camera on the air?
A little bit. Why?
Well, this is like the camera right now.
That's the camera.
Do you have it set on silent shutter?
No, but you press this button right here, and then you can choose silent shutter. It might be.
I think it was because I just took some pictures.
Yeah, it's silent.
Yeah, it makes no noise.
That's silent.
Yeah, it's annoying, but it does it by charging the.
What it does is it has normally, if you turn the silent shutter off, a regular metal curtain.
Right, for normal.
And then it goes out of the way because it is a mirrorless, so there's no mirror, but there's still a curtain. But if you turn it to silent, it does a digital curtain because it's a
you don't
video
need,
camera basically, right? So you don't have to have a shutter. They just turn it on and off real fast.
Now, how do you grow the image?
Grow it?
Well, so I can focus. Oh, there it is. Never mind.
Oh, yeah. That's C1. So you can reprogram all those buttons so you can do that.
This is a camera. This is a fantastic camera.
Trey Ratcliffe, who is, of course, one of our favorite photographers, says that that camera is the best digital camera made today, probably the best digital camera he's ever used.
I believe it only does 5. Brackets 5 for HDR, does not do 7.
You can do 9.
Oh, you can? I didn't see it in the specs.
You can do 9.
Oh, you can?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And what's the name and model?
This is the Sony.
Yeah, get this. Dwight. Buy one of these.
It's only $3,000, Dwight, minus the lens. The A7R II.
The lens is another grand.
No, that's an $8,000 lens.
No, it's this. I'm saying the lens you can get from them.
Yeah, yeah,
make
yeah.
a good lens.
It's expensive.
Mm. No, it's this $8,000 lens is very unique. Not everybody has these.
Not everybody has that, baby.
Oh.
You got to be still, crazy. I keep, I just,
I know
I'll be honest.
It's a hilarious story.
I keep hoping I'll become a better photographer if I just buy enough gear. Someday, I will have. Look at, even Justine's dog has a hoverboard. That's that's how hip.
You got to get one of those hoverboards, Leo. You'd be bombing around.
Did we send these back? Didn't we have these? We reviewed them, I thought, on Before You Buy. I feel like, though, if you don't have a handle to hold, you have to balance or something. Do you think they're harder to
it's
ride?
Like, you think? It's like a skateboard. If you can't ride a skateboard, you know.
My son can ride a skateboard, so he probably won't. Look at Justine. Look at her go. You go, girl.
She can probably ride a skateboard, too. If yeah. I were you, I wouldn't get one of these. You're going to kill yourself.
Guaranteed.
Put your eye out, kid.
Guaranteed. And then who will get my $8,000 lens?
Well, put it me in the will. I will actually be one of the few people that would appreciate having
you
this
appreciate
lens.
That lens.
Yeah.
You now you're a pretty serious photographer. I know you like
I
your
take a
Olympus
lot of shots.
And, yeah,
but
do you put them up anywhere? Do you?
I have them in the house, and I've entered them.
No, but I mean, like, you've entered competitions.
Yeah.
Have you won?
Yeah, I've won a couple of things.
Nice. I didn't know this about you.
Well, that's one of my hobbies.
Do you post them on Flickr, Smug Mug,
no.
Google Photo? Nowhere we can see them.
I blow most of my stuff up to huge sizes.
How big?
44 by.
Oh, see, you would want this camera. It's 42 megapixels. You don't need that many megapixels for, you know.
When you're doing
snapshots. Yeah.
Snapshots.
No, you don't.
Yeah.
Actually, one of my best pictures I shot with a little pocket camera.
We're going to the Supreme Court, kids. Apple and Samsung. Samsung is going to appeal to the Supreme Court. You remember that a couple of years ago, a federal jury in San Jose found that Samsung had ripped off Apple and their iPhone patents, awarded several hundred million dollars to Apple.
Yes.
On Wednesday, Samsung says, we're going to appeal. We're not giving you the money because we're going all the way to the Supreme Court. Why not?
What's interesting about this is, you know, they've got a lot of support. Google, Facebook, right. HP, they're all backing them because it feels like, you know, Steve Jobs famously, you know, was going to start a nuclear war over the ripoff of iOS. And he may have overreached in that original suit with the design patent stuff. I mean, it's the thing that everybody makes fun of.
So there's two suits. There were two issues. There were physical patents, but the more important ones were the kind of the trade dress patents, that this looks like an iPhone, and it's intentionally done that way to confuse the consumer.
Right, and those things are those trade dress patents are perceived by the industry as dangerous.
Well, it's really subjective. I mean, it's not. You can't say objectively. Oh, that's obviously that was.
It's perceived by the industry, but what is the law? What is the current state of the law?
Well, the patent law is so.
It's a mess.
Right.
Yeah, and right. You know, even patent law lawyers can't figure it out. So, and it's being written by it's. You know, where do we start? I mean, stuff gets patented that probably shouldn't get patented, and then more stuff gets patented that maybe used the stuff that already got patented that shouldn't have been. And, you know, we're way deep in a mess.
It's a nightmare, and we can't get out of it.
Here's some good news. Steve Jobs just got a patent for the iPod Shuffle. He just was awarded. He died 4 years ago, but he was just awarded. The Shuffle came out 10 years ago, but he was just awarded a patent for the iPod Shuffle.
So you can see how efficient this system is.
Jeez Louise.
You said Jeez Louise.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Do you know her?
That's funny.
Yeah, I think it's Louise Brooks probably, right? Don't you think? You remember Louise Brooks?
No.
No? Philip, you remember Louise Brooks?
I don't actually. Sorry.
Why am I older than everybody on this show?
Only in spirit.
The original Bob, right?
Oh, and that's why people said, geez, Louise?
I'm thinking it's around that era. She was a movie star in the 20s. Geez Louise, right?
Yeah, you're older than I am then.
Yeah, definitely.
Did you date her or what was it?
I don't even remember that from film school.
I will never forget Pandora's Box, one of the great 4 out of 4 stars, Roger Ebert. 90% on Rotten Tomatoes. It was
what year?
Acclaimed German silent film. She played Lulu, a woman so beautiful and alluring that few can resist her siren charms. 1929. Ah,
just before the switchover.
Directed by G.W. Pabst.
Pabst?
Pabst, the great.
Yeah, he probably got a blue ribbon for that.
At least the Total Security Award. Very least. We're going to take a break. Are you Audible book listeners? I got the cutest picture.
Yes, I have listened.
Love audiobooks. So I'm walking by the barbershop yesterday. Let me see if I can find this photo. I'm walking by the barbershop yesterday, and I look through the window, and this kid, he is not happy about getting his hair cut. He's making the most sourpuss face I ever saw. And I came in. I said, can I take your picture? I asked his dad, can I take your picture? I said, he looks so miserable.
Probably his first haircut.
Under there. That's what I thought. Oh, it's a first haircut or something like that. So I said, why are you so, no, that's somebody else. Why are you so,
shot that in HDR.
Yeah. Why are you so, look at that. I said, why are you so unhappy? So I'm not unhappy. I'm listening to an audiobook. I said, what? He pulled out his iPod Touch. He was listening to Diary of a Wimpy Kid while he was getting his hair cut. I have high hopes for the future of this country. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
How do they cut around the earbuds?
I didn't see earbuds, but, I don't know how he's listening. Maybe it's coming through. I don't know. Coming through the sheet? It was the cutest thing I ever saw.
He was just hearing it in his head.
No, he showed me. It was Diary of a Wimpy Kid. He showed me. He had it on his iPod Touch.
Doesn't mean he did anything. Huh?
We love Audible. Kids love Audible. Adults love Audible. One of the things that research shows is that kids who listen, you would think, oh, I want the kid to look at a book and read it. Kids who listen to audiobooks, Diary of a Wimpy Kid, great choice, are become better readers because they're listening, they get engaged, they also, you know, bring out the book, they look at the book. I want to talk a little bit about a group of kids that, you know, James Patterson, of course, the great best-selling author. He has teamed up with Audible to help a group of kids. They call them reluctant readers. James says, I was a reluctant reader. My dad was a reluctant reader, but reading is so important. I think it's maybe the single most important thing a kid can learn in school. So Patterson's on a personal mission to inspire kids to discover that reading is fun, it's entertainment, it's great. And this summer, he's partnering with Audible to create a program that encourages young readers to make their way to books by listening to audiobooks. I think we found one young reader who is very much into his audiobooks. The program focuses on family listening. I think that's a great idea. I have very fond memories of listening to It's Not Easy Being Brown with my kids. It's just wonderful. It recommends titles, suggests genres that parents and kids will enjoy together. In fact, Patterson's put together a recommended listening list. And Audible, kudos to you, Audible, is providing those audiobooks at a discount. Plus, reading guides for families, particularly on Patterson's featured series, Middle School, Daniel X, and Treasure Hunters. They're having an Instagram campaign to have kids and families show where listening took them. It's countless studies have shown that listening to books improves early literacy skills. It expands vocabularies. It elevates comprehension. Narrators can bring the text to life, which helps kids. There, that's a great one, Treasure Hunters, which helps kids really get engaged in reading and in stories. And, you know, they can listen while cleaning their rooms, while getting their hair cut, while on the road. That's what we did. We were on a road trip, and we listened the whole way, and it was so much fun. For a special summer promotion to encourage reluctant readers, just a reduced price, just $4.95 a book, audible.com/Patterson, PATTERSON. I was listening to I wanted to hear his first book, Along Came a Spider. Great book.
The chat room's saying it doesn't help with spelling, but I guess that's why God invented spell checks.
You know what? My kids spell so poorly. Actually, Henry's not too bad, but Abby's terrible. Always was, because when they were little, there was this fad called whole language.
Mm.
And yeah, we had learned with phonetics, right? But phonetics have been the school. Oh, phonetics are
no good.
No good. So they encouraged them, believe it or not, to spell it any way they wanted to.
Inventive
spelling. You know about this.
Yeah, that's what my kids had, but they ended up being good spellers.
Yeah, you know, I think it's almost genetic.
If you do a lot of chatting online with my kids,
that helps
because people laugh at you. Hey, you're an idiot.
Literacy is more. Yeah, in some ways, literacy is bigger now because of that, because of typing.
So I went to the kitchen.
Yeah.
So he says, find the red vines. Which
no, but you
there.
Found something so much better.
Why would any? Why would this be in the cabinet as a snack?
Dinty Moore beef stew. It's why not? That's good.
When I'm in the, when beef I'm stew. Going to do the Twitch show, I'm going to look forward to some beef stew.
It's good.
I got these. These look like at least edible.
What is that?
I don't know. Some sun-kissed.
Some. So here's Lamar Wilson. As a video on YouTube, fat guy on hoverboard. So these are Carled hoverboards.
Okay. Even though they're not actually
they're not hovering. Floating in the air.
Right.
And all the kids are doing it, including Wiz Khalifa and Justine. And wow.
Didn't the guy... I got to get one of those. I got one. I got to get one of those.
You'll scream like a girl.
Can you, do a skateboard?
Not in a long time. I don't know. I used to.
Well, then you can probably do this.
Is this
a No. Twizzlers are not better than red vines. Done. Somebody's in the chat room said.
Have some Dinty Moore beef stew. It'll cheer you up.
No, I don't think so.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Philip.
Didn't the guy who bought Segway die?
No.
Taking his Segway off a cliff?
Yes.
No, so, that was the CEO.
Yeah, but he was a British investor. I think he was like the third guy to buy it. Segway was not, and is still not, the most financially viable company in the world. He had one of those off-road Segways and apparently took it off-road. There's some question whether he had a heart attack before or after he rode it off the cliff.
Yeah. I was at a time when that the Segway first came out, and they were actually considering putting it on the cover.
Yeah.
There was a Project a writer. There was a writer who was very excited to write a Time cover about it, and nobody at Time had seen it. So they sent me up to New Hampshire to kick the tires and see if this was a cover worthy. And I met everybody and I listened to their business model and I could tell.
There's no business model.
Well, their pitch was, China, we've got a problem with China. They all want to have cars. If all of China gets a car, the planet's going to heat up and go to hell. So the solution is to give them Segways. And these things were selling for, what, $600 or $700?
I just bought two. They're $6,500 each.
I think they were like three or four back then.
This is going to replace the bicycle?
No,
in
but
China?
It's sure fun to ride.
Oh, we ran it inside. We didn't do it on the cover.
And by the way, a few years later, Time Magazine, the 10 biggest tech failures of the last decade. Number one, Segway.
The Segway.
Here we go.
So it was not Dean Kamen, who is a brilliant inventor who invented the Segway. It was not he who went off the cliff. I think a lot of people think that's the case. It was a British investor. The saddest story of this all is that Segway had fought for years to keep a Chinese clone of the Segway out of the United States, fought successfully. They just got bought by the Chinese clone company about 6 months ago.
The chat room
ironic
that the Segway is cheaper than your lens.
I probably sound like worst one percenter of all
this
time.
This is the worst. This is the most decadent thing anyone's ever owned that I know.
But I live on Dinty Moore beef stew because I give up those things for my art. It is pretty decadent.
I like it. I like the fact that you have this lens.
I don't know what to say.
Because I can shoot a picture on it once.
I'm not going to pretend to false humility.
No. You've got the lens and everyone... This rig I'm holding in my hands. $12,000.
That's ridiculous. I just wanted to be a better photographer, John. That's all I wanted.
That's almost as much as an Apple Watch.
Oh, God.
$12,000.
This is the company that bought Segway, the Ninebot. They also
and
make this...
And it doesn't even have autofocus.
No, that's the whole thing.
Yeah, well, you don't want autofocus.
You pay more money to not have autofocus.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
Yeah. They make this ridiculous contraption. This is a wheel.
Oh.
These pedals flip down... And you stand around and you roll around in this thing.
Yeah, you look like a complete lunatic in that thing.
Did you see there's one that looks like a bathroom scale?
And you just float around on that?
And you sit on it and you ride around and you can steer and all that stuff.
You're going to get one?
You know what they're touting? They're saying this is going to be huge in China.
Right.
There you go. Now that China's broke, I don't think anything's going to be huge in China. Right. Hey, is it over for China now?
No.
You know, when we were in China in 2009, I was really impressed. I mean, Shanghai, they were building a new skyscraper every few days.
Oh, yeah.
It really was go-go.
At one point, like 90% of the world's cranes.
Amazing. Mm. And I thought, this culture, you know, we were in the American century. I feel that maybe the 21st century will be called the Chinese century.
Not if we have anything to do
with it. Well, I mentioned it to my guide, and he said, no, you don't understand. The economic underpinnings of this are completely fragile. And he said, this is not a stable economy. And he was right. I mean, but it took a few years to...
No, they're still kicking butt.
They're still going to kick butt? Yeah. Look, they got a wheel with pedals that you can... Iridescent.
How much are they selling that for? What's that sell for?
It's got to be cheaper than a Segway. They also sell an atmosphere lamp that's full of personality.
An atmosphere lamp? What does that mean?
I don't know.
Like the top of the Amazon Echo.
Non-visual lifting handle design. I think there's a language issue here.
Mm-hmm.
Being compatible with popular accessories.
Mm. Being. All right. Yeah, you're right. The Ashley Madison hack was Chinese.
Right.
It doesn't take much to figure it
out.
Would
you rather have this or
I'd like to see somebody driving
hoverboard.
They just show the model. I don't know. Is it could be 2 feet high.
Look, you got an app.
Could be a little bitty thing.
The Ninedroid app. Tracking all the time.
Looks like you're in one of those giant tires.
It's basically, all of these are just Segways without the handle, right? That's all I know.
I want one of these.
Yeah. Let's take a break. This was a good week on Twit, and we have taken the liberty of piecing together some highlights from the week's best shows. Take a look.
Previously on Twit.
Oh, my God, look at that loud shirt. Turn that thing down.
Yeah, I had to put in earplugs just to wear it on.
Tech News Today.
If you needed any more evidence that the patent process moves way too slowly, here it is. The late Apple co-founder and CEO Steve Jobs was granted a patent this week for the iPod Shuffle. Jobs died about 4 years ago.
This shows exactly how backed up the patent system is.
This Week in Google.
I love the R&D stuff at Google. This is mind-boggling. Yeah. I imagine Larry sitting in a chair like this, with his fingers steepled.
He's wearing entirely white.
And Larry says... thrill me. And the engineer has 5 minutes.
Does he have a cat in his arms?
Yeah, he could have Mr. Bigglesworth in his
arms.
You nailed it. Yeah, that's exactly how it is.
All about Android.
As we finally get the unveiling of what Android M actually means, and it is marshmallow.
Marshmallow.
And now the marshmallow's on fire.
That's how you get the nice and crispy. This is how you do it. All right, so then you take... Okay, sorry, continue.
Twit. Thousands of hours of high-quality dribble.
Is the Android robot our size, and that's an enormous marshmallow, or is the Android robot marshmallow size?
These are really important
questions. I looked all through the PR material from Google PR, and I did not see that.
Inquiring minds want to know.
That was it?
That's it. That was the best of the week.
Wow. It was a bad week.
Yeah. Okay, I'll grant you that. You know what a bad week? Jeff Bezos, after that New York Times article last week.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
And you know, it's really interesting to watch the back and forth. People say, no, first of all, didn't happen. That was the New York Times taking straight aim at the owner of the Washington Post. There are those who say, yeah, it happens. It's a startup. Well, 10-year-old startup, but it's like, you know, it's
more than that.
It's a very engaged company. When you go to work for a company like Amazon, you expect to work long hours, get emails in the middle of the night and things like that.
Yeah.
Where do you go? Where do you fall down?
My thinking on this whole thing has gotten... I thought originally that it was the Washington Post versus the New York Times because they've been chiding each other.
Right.
So somebody decided to take a pot shot at Bezos. But now I'm thinking, this is, you know, if you look up unions versus Amazon, I think you find the genesis of this thing. Amazon's been fighting the unions left and right. The big newspapers are all unionized. I don't know about the Chronicle. But the New York Times is a huge union operation. This is what it is. It's just just give it to this guy because he won't let the unions in. That's what I think.
There aren't any union papers in Texas.
No, it's Texas.
Oh, Texas. Oh, okay.
Oh,
that
Texas.
Makes sense.
I worked for the only one, the San Antonio Light, God rest its soul, was a union paper, but there are no.
The big cities up north are almost all union papers.
What I think happened here is that, you know, when they talk to both current and older former employees usually have some kind of gripe. And I think there are probably pockets where you have, unacceptable managers who abuse their people, who kind of take the kind of approach. And there are some who don't. And there was the story by the guy who was an Amazon employee who sought to debunk it.
Yeah, he published it in the Medium. Yeah.
Right. He was in a meeting, he said, where the guy said, yeah, we used to burn people to the ground in this place. And so I think they may have done that at one time across the board, but I suspect, that it's probably been diluted since. And the New York Times probably just got kind of a blinder view of what actually happens in there. It's too complex for.
Yeah, but it still seemed like a hit piece.
It did feel like that. In fact, Margaret Sullivan.
They got chided.
Who's their ombudsman, right? Said, "Yeah, we could have done a better job balancing this. Yes. We could have tried to find some other employees with opinions somewhat differing." It did feel like a hit piece. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Philip.
Well, I was going to say that they got chided by the ombudsman person, I think.
Yeah.
The people who say, oh, you look at any of these companies, you look at Microsoft, you look at Apple, you look at Facebook, and you get the same kind of behavior. People went back to say, look at the soul of the new machine, the same kind of startup intensity, the long hours.
That's a good point.
I don't think it was the long hours that bothered people about that article. It was the woman who had the miscarriage and was told she had to come back to work.
The bullying.
I do think that Bezos is different. I think he's missing the gene for human empathy. And he's got control of a company and a lot of people.
You pointed us to Jonah Serra's piece in the New York Times, the opinion pages. And I think the salient article, Serra writes, it's worth remembering that Amazon is a first generation internet company. Its peers, including Yahoo and AOL, are a shell of their former selves, even as Amazon has become ever more important and powerful. Whatever you think about his methods, he has managed to keep Amazon absolutely relevant.
But he's burned through. First of all, you forget that they already did a hit piece on Amazon for what goes on in their warehouses. There was no air conditioning. People were being worked to death. And finally, Amazon, they put the air conditioners in. This is strictly about the white collar workers, their upper level management. Right. And I totally believe what the Times reported, that they work these guys just as hard as they possibly can. And when the guys start to break down, they get rid of them and bring in a new crop. They're treating people like they're fungible. There's plenty of people who would be happy to work at Amazon. You get a good training. You can only do it for so long because it's too much. And other companies aren't like that. People get hired by Apple to do a certain job, and they stay there for 30 years. There's got to be something different about Amazon.
People uniformly said it was horrible. The worst job I ever had working for Steve Jobs, and I will never forget it, and I will never regret it. It's a double-edged thing.
These are those masochists at work in Silicon Valley, though. I think it's being, I think if the Mr. Robot show is kind of exploring this a little bit.
Are they? Are they going to get into that now?
Well, the whole show is about kind of the sickness of high-end programming.
Leo, are you not watching Mr. Robot?
I watched the pilot and I loved it. I thought it was great.
It's incredible.
It's getting better?
Incredible show.
It's astonishing.
Oh, man. It's probably the best show on TV right now.
No, I like the first episode.
I would agree.
Okay, good.
Where is it? Where is it?
What USA Network of all places.
Yes, it's offbeat.
It's on USA, which USA is owned by NBC Universal, so it's not of all places. It's kind of where they're doing.
Yeah, but it's where they dump stuff usually.
Yes,
it's
their dumping ground.
If they ever bring back, Starsky and Hutch, it'll be on USA Network.
So
the Dukes of Hazzard, Redux, that's going to be in the USA.
It's available on their archives. It's on iTunes and Amazon.
It's easy to get.
It's fantastic. And my wife, who is not a techie and not at all interested in hacker culture, is mesmerized. And when you know, we're cord cutters, and when we get the email from iTunes saying this is available, she says, let's watch it, let's watch it. It's really good.
I love the sheriff. Leon, Dukes of Hazzard is actually a Warner Brothers property. I don't think NBC Universal will be bringing that back.
Chat room has a clue. They're giving it to you, and you deserve it.
I deserve it. I earned that.
Dukes of Hazzard.
Okay, I have a question. I don't know if it's a spoiler because I haven't been watching it. But Steve Gibson and I both have posited.
Posited?
Posited.
Woo!
That the hoodie guy, whatever his name is, and the hacker guy, played by, what's his name, Christian Slater.
Everybody knows this.
It's like Fight Club.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I'm just, has that paid off yet?
Well,
or no?
It's not like Fight Club in the sense that it's his alter ego.
Okay.
But it's very similar.
Do they tell you this?
They show you on, I think, episode 5.
Okay.
Episode 9. Episode 9.
Oh,
the one they
God,
just
I'm
did
spoiled
it.
Just the, I spoiled
is that 9?
9 episodes for people.
Episode 9, yeah. The
is
the
that
one
far along and you've only watched episode 1?
Yeah. 1.
Wow.
Episode 10 is the final one. It's this week.
Oh,
I didn't know that.
That's exciting.
Yep. I've become an evangelist for this show. I think it's just spectacular.
I'm going to sit down. There's too many shows. You know, I hate
this. This is an important show you have to watch.
But there's too many good shows.
No, this is he's right. This is the
he's
top
right.
show.
He's right. This is the show you
the
have
show.
To watch.
Okay. It raises issues that we deal with
I
here.
I don't know what it does.
Oh, yeah.
It's just entertaining as hell.
Have you been watching Humans?
Yeah, I like Humans a lot.
I have not seen Humans.
Yeah. Humans
is
good.
Humans is very good.
That was one.
Okay, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Right into the old review section of the
that
Twit
was
broadcast.
One where the chat room goes, well, actually, the original Swedish version was much better. I rib you because I love you, chat room.
Yeah, that's not
by
the way,
way
they see it.
The good news here, according to The Onion, Jeff Bezos assures Amazon employees that HR is working 100 hours a week to address their complaints. Bezos says, nothing matters more to me than the well-being of our employees, and our HR staff will continue to work their fingers to the bone, not seeing their families, not seeing their friends, or anything at all outside their offices for as long as it takes to make this right. Bezos added that any employee not fully committed to ensuring a healthy work-life balance should look for a job elsewhere. So that, you see?
Yeah.
He's addressed it.
Yeah. I'm glad The Onion's still around.
I love The Onion.
Let's go to Hot Topic.
What is a hot topic?
Hot topic.
You want a hot topic?
Yeah.
I don't think we've discussed the Skylake CPU yet.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, what else?
Sprint's going to abandon 2-year contracts, just like T-Mobile and Verizon.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm.
Have you found Marty Rim?
What?
I did.
You found him?
Yeah.
Where'd you find him?
I did a Kickstarter. Raised,
really?
$600.
No. What?
Hired a private eye in New York. And
so how did you
him.
Pitch? How did you pitch the Kickstarter? How do you say I want to hire a private detective? How did you pitch that?
I said we're coming up to the 20th anniversary of the cover that ended my career as a tech journalist. and this guy who was my source.
Wait a minute, you got to tell this story. It started from the beginning.
All right. 20 years ago, last July, Time ran a cover story on cyber porn that was immediately ripped to pieces by the civil libertarians, among others, mostly Mike Godwin, the Mike Godwin of Godwin's Law, that any internet discussion will eventually invoke Hitler. Anyway, the source for this story was a Carnegie Mellon undergraduate who purported to count how many pornographic pictures there were. This is the early days of the internet. So we're talking about Usenet and porn BBSs. And, you know, Time just loves two things. One, exclusives, and two, numbers. So he was offering us an exclusive access to the numbers of pornographic pictures on the internet. And I was a green enough writer that to get a cover opportunity, I ran with this thing. Late in the week, about Thursday, as I'm finally reading this report, and I'm starting to think, ooh, this is really shoddy research. But I was too deep into it, and I was too green. And I went ahead and wrote this cover story. And it had a picture of a kid with wide eyes and at a keyboard.
Awesome photo,
and obviously
by the way.
Shot. There you
Great
are. You
photo.
Can see it there.
Great photo.
And it wasn't a photo. It was a Photoshop thing. And inside it right. had a naked man humping a computer. I mean, the art was amazing.
And you got to put this in context because this is 1995. Right. This is the beginning of the internet, and nobody was even aware that this was happening.
Probably. Well, there were the bulletin boards in the 80s.
But it was not.
There was a lot
knowledge.
Of porn. Well, I don't know about that, but okay, keep going.
The rule about any new medium is pornography becomes the first thing that makes money. Anyway, the cover came out and Godwin guy, all the guys on the Well, you know what that was?
I was a member.
Yeah, you still have a Well address, I believe.
Fortune got tired of paying the $100 a year, so I lost that account. Anyway, they leaped on this cover and ripped it to dish. They hired they got some academics to look at the methodology, and it was terrible. So Rim hung around for his name is Marty Rim, and he hung around for a couple of weeks. He did an interview with the New York Times. He was on ABC Nightline. And then they started to find out about his past, which had some weird stuff in it. And he disappeared. And nobody had seen him for 20 years. Mm. So we were coming up to the 20th anniversary, and I thought, you know, if I'm going to do something about this, because it had kind of haunted me, I'd looked for him.
Did you regret it?
Oh, yeah. Geez, it was terrible. I had to stop writing. I became an editor.
That's not hyperbole. You really
became an editor.
Wow.
I edited science for 12 years.
And editors, as we know from last week.
Evil.
Oh, I haven't.
You have to listen to last week's show.
John's very...
Do you know the editor joke? There's one funny editor joke. Shall I tell it?
Yeah.
So editor and writer are get lost. They're covering the Gulf War. They get lost in the desert. They climb over, you know, these hills. Mirages appear and disappear. And finally, they're about to die of thirst when they go over one more hill, and there's an oasis. Mm-hmm. And there's a pool of clean, clear, cold water. And the writer goes, and he sticks his head, and he's drinking the water. And the editor, he realizes, is standing behind him, pissing into it. And the writer says, "What the hell are you doing?" And the editor says, "It's okay. I'm making it better."
That's a good joke.
From a writer's perspective.
That's a very classic, I would say, yeah.
Yeah, it turns out it's an army joke.
Yeah,
it's
I'm making it better.
General.
Yeah.
Anyway, 20 years later, I pitch it to Fortune. They say they're sort of interested in my story about it, but they feel uncomfortable about hiring a detective. But they said, if you want to do it with Kickstarter, that's okay with us. Wow. So raise the money on Kickstarter. It took me like 3 days. And hired the guy and got a home address and a work address. And I waited, and you know, I thought I had fantasies of doing a whole podcast, and I taped a bunch of interviews with everybody around the story. And then I finally said, I got to go try to find the guy. So I drove down to he lived outside White Plains, and I took a day and I drove down there really early in the morning. I parked outside his house and I waited and waited and waited and waited, and nobody ever came out. And I knocked on the door and the dogs were barking, and it finally gave up. And I went to his place of business, where before she wised up to me, the receptionist identified him from his picture. Oh yeah, he works here. And then she got freaked out and wouldn't talk to me anymore. Anyway, he was clearly ducking me. In fact, he scrubbed all his LinkedIn. He's got a new name. He changed his name.
Why was he ducking you?
You know, I'm not quite sure.
He doesn't want to relive it.
Yeah, someone said he learned early on that if you screw up badly enough on the internet, there's nothing to do but to get a new identity.
But you know what? I think that 20 years later, hindsight has proven him not so far off.
Well, he was far off in that his thesis was that people would go to the internet for the kind of porn that you couldn't get in the magazine stand. That it would be, I won't even go into
paraphilia. You know. He was short-sighted. He just didn't realize they'd go to the internet for any kind of porn they could find.
Right. It's basically mainstream porn is what most people go for.
Well, just like the real world,
And even Godwin says, you know, now the internet is awash with porn. And, you know, you just have to learn how to raise your kids within it. Anyway, he was that part of his thesis was wrong, and we played it up big in the billboard of our
On the other hand...
Well,
yeah. I would grant him that the porn is certainly one of the number one, if not the number one, uses of the internet.
Email. So let's wrap the story. Did you get a hold of him?
Here, the end of the story is here. I go back to his house. It's the afternoon. I'm banging on the door. The
like a madman.
the dogs are barking at me and then looking back at something and then barking some more. And it hit me, you know, this guy is probably right on the other side of the door. And for the first time, I put myself in his shoes and what it's like to have me.
Of all people.
Right. He's been trying to avoid me for 20 years. And here I am outside his door. And I felt like a stalker. And I decided.
He was probably aware of the Kickstarter.
Did you? Not necessarily.
Oh, yeah. I got.
Did you yell, open the door, you son of a bitch?
You ruined my life.
No, I didn't.
He collected 917,000 images, descriptions, short stories, and animations from BBSs.
So, which is what I was talking about, the 80s. Now. Yeah. So that's the end of the story? You never did get a hold of him or what?
Yeah. And
that's a disappointment.
I mean, I found out where he was. I found out what happened to him.
Marty Rim, wherever you are. Wait a minute. Let me look at my wallet.
He's not watching the show.
I got a $20 bill right here.
Bring him on the show.
You come on this show.
Do triangulation.
$100.
$100.
No, I'm not giving him that camera. Stop it. Wow.
So that's the story. And I had been trying to get This American Life interested in doing the whole, you know, I was thinking of doing the whole, what was the name of that podcast that was so popular where she chased down
Serial.
Serial. Yeah. I had fantasies of doing a Serial kind of thing until I realized I know nothing about
it. You should have offered Rim a job.
So This American Life ignored me totally until
it feels like that would be a great This American Life story.
Yeah.
So then they're clueless.
Then they finally responded to me and said, wait, you didn't talk to him?
That does kind of spoil it, doesn't it?
Yeah, ruins it.
Yeah.
Or it makes it a better story.
Well, it depends if you're drinking the water or pissing in it.
Right. Hey, yo.
Ho. Yeah.
Uh-oh. So, Philip, there's a podcast called Reply All.
This whole section out, you know that.
Probably. That dives into kind of the background and the history of things on the internet, and they would love this story.
What's it called?
Reply All. It's a Gimlet Media podcast.
Why are you sending him elsewhere? This is a podcast network. We make podcasts every day.
When I was listening to this,
it sounded like one of theirs. Yeah. And well, I did. I pitched it to Gimlet. Great. You should buy it.
Gimlet is Serial, right? Gimlet's the same guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. I pitched it to Gimlet.
Is NPR, isn't it?
No, it's a spinoff.
It's a spinoff. Gimlet is the Planet Money guys, and they do Serial. They do Startup. They do...
The Startup is about the story of cyber porn, part one.
I only listen to and help produce and take part in the No Agenda Show at noagendashow.com.
You can do that.
We just concentrate on this.
Why don't you do this story on No Agenda Show?
That's not a No Agenda thing. He never talked to him.
What is a No Agenda thing?
Well, listen, if someone will back me, I will talk to him. You know, I had no backing. Fortune.
What do you mean? You want weapons? What do you want?
He wants backup.
Going strong? What are you talking about?
I'm talking about a sound engineer.
Oh, I see.
No, he needs a bullhorn.
Come on out, Rim.
We know you're in there.
Rim.
I did what I can do. I wrote a piece. I'm a writer.
Marty Rim. Where are you?
If he sees this, he's never going to talk to him now.
It's kind of like that movie Searching for J.D. Salinger, only not at all. Our show today brought to you by your shaving system, Harry's. We were talking about Harry's before the
Where's my
show? You want some Harry's? I'll get you some Harry's.
You got some in the back.
Get some Harry's for Mr. Dvorak. Harry's is actually...
Right-o.
You can all go to harrys.com. Sometimes people say... Shaving's not fun.
Isn't this something you have to subscribe to?
No, you don't. You can just go there and buy them whenever you need them. But it starts with the Harry's kit. So get the Harry's kit.
I like the orange handle.
Yeah, that would be the Truman. They have a Truman and they have a Winston.
You got the Truman for me?
That's the Truman set. Oh, well, let's see what we got for you. Let's see what John's got.
This is what you come on the show for.
By the way, I'm not going to tell John. This is only $15, and if you use the offer code TWIT5, it's only $10.
Oh. It's just the best you can do.
When he sees what you get, though, he's just going to love it. Because this for $10, you're going to get not only the incredible Harry's blade. Oh, this is the Winston. It's the metal one. Sorry, John. But you get three blades, the incredible handle. You also get and I think this is sometimes overlooked. Do not throw this out. This is not packaging. This is the travel cover.
Ah.
So it's really great. You never cut yourself on the dop kit, right?
Very important.
I think this is not to be overlooked.
Yeah, the things bounce around in your suitcase.
Yeah, they get dull.
You got
You want a sharp blade.
Cut wide open.
Exactly. It also, now, you have your choice. They have a, I personally prefer the cream, but they also have a foaming shave gel for those gentlemen who like a foaming shave gel. Would you like to shave right now?
No.
You have a pretty clean shave. It looks like you actually shave before the show.
I always shave before the show.
That's very nice of you. There are those who don't. There are those who, like baseball players, shave after the show. They like to play with a little
grizzle. They like the stubble.
The stubble. This is $10. It's a great gift for dad or grad. Great gift for yourself. The thing to understand about Harry's that's unique, the guys who started, and it was one of the guys was Jeff who started Warby Parker. We're doing the research. How do you make this a better experience for people, shaving a better experience? And what he found out is, well, of course, it comes down to the blade. There's two factories in the whole world, in Solingen, Germany.
Deutschland.
Right? That's where the knives are made. The Germans make good blades. They bought the freaking factory.
Oh.
They actually went to Germany and they bought the factory. So now you're in effect buying direct from the factory and you buy from Harrys.com. That means two things. First of all, they're engineered for precision, for performance, for accuracy, for sharpness. But also, of course, you're buying direct, so you don't have to pay those drugstore prices. There are no middlemen. Harrys.com. It starts with a kit. Go get a kit. Get $5 off that kit when you use the offer code TWIT5. You don't have to subscribe, but you're probably going to want to. You can subscribe and get blades by mail. You can get the razor, the shaving cream or the foam. They also have I love the aftershave lotion, which cools and calms your skin and makes you smell fantastic. You might like this too, John. I love this. This is a razor stand. You can get that engraved. Put that right on the sink, and your razor's always upright and ready.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yep. Yep. That's the way to be.
There you go. Harry's, Harrys.
Do they have anything for us bearded gentlemen, Leo? Nope.
Well, now, wait, let me ask you. Do you got to shave, like, underneath? You don't want a neck
beard.
I got to
shave the cheek and the neck, yeah.
Yeah. So, well, you still need a razor.
Throat beard.
Unless,
I think I'll do this.
Are you not one of those electric shaver razor guys? Are you?
No.
That's something.
But I need electric trimmer, you know, it helps.
Yeah. That's to keep the beard under control. You're not going to use a razor for that.
I don't get yelled at work.
You are going to like this a lot.
You yelled at work.
You smell great afterwards. Harrys.com. Offer code is TWIT and the number 5, just so you know, to get $5 off.
TWIT 5.
TWIT, TWIT 5.
That's actually probably the best deal you have on the show.
For $10, all of this?
Yeah.
$10 would buy you two blades at CVS.
One.
Not even two.
And then you get electrocuted. Right.
That's the Winston with the metal handle. Steve Gibson likes the Truman. He likes the, because the metal handle's cold in the morning. He likes the plastic handle, and the plastic handle has a flat side, so he always has it in the right direction. I guess Steve, I don't know, maybe shaves in the dark. I don't know. Some people do.
Shaves in the dark.
Shaving in the dark.
Yes, that's a good one.
What were the chances? Hey, I promised you we'd get you out of here before the Niners-Cowboys game.
Yeah, you missed.
I missed it. I got a couple of headlines.
Although I think kickoff's probably not.
Okay, we got a little time. Couple of headlines. Chinese police arrest 15,000 people this month for internet crimes.
Yeah.
So you see, you think maybe they're not paying attention to the hackers? Oh, no, they are paying attention. Police said in China on Tuesday they had arrested 15,000 people for crimes that jeopardized internet security.
What were they doing, using a VPN?
I'm thinking they were searching Google for Tianemen Square. I don't know.
The thing it really gets was that Falun Gong operation.
Falun Gong, yeah.
They go crazy over that.
They did not make clear over what period those arrests were made. 15,000. I hope it's more than a month. They targeted websites. Yeah, see, listen, this is the clue. They targeted websites providing illegal and harmful information.
Falun Gong.
Yeah. And or advertisements for pornography, explosives, firearms, and gambling.
Huh.
I have mixed feelings about this. You know, we talk a lot about porn on the net or whatever, but you want the opposite, which is this kind of censorship.
That's where it's all headed.
I hope not. In February, they said they'd ban internet accounts that impersonate people or organizations and force people to use their real names when registering for online accounts.
Now, that would be an improvement.
Well, it would get rid of a... I don't think so. As much as I get hurt by anonymous trolling, I still think it's important to allow people to get online anonymously. And
it's the American way.
I think it's important.
Yeah. The chat room exhibits this behavior.
We could say to the chat room, you have to use your real name and prove it and stuff. We thought about that.
Nobody in the chat room.
It's so much more fun that you've got Art Man 1033, Nuclear Jello, Loquacious One. That's more fun.
Well, at least it's not loquacious.
Well, and some of them are women. And I think that they quite rightly don't want to be Betty, Sally, and Mary Jane in there. Because that is going to just get unwanted attention and nastiness.
Bad, horrible unwanted attention. People should be ashamed of themselves.
I'm looking at you, Tater. No, I'm not. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Locutus. Locutus. That's what it is.
Locutus.
Locutus. That's the guy, the Borg.
The Borg.
Locutus of Borg.
Look, that's a good handle. Do you want that? Because I might use that if you don't want it.
What would I use it for?
I don't. The chat room. You could be Locutus of Borg.
I become John. I'm in the chat room now. I'm John C. Dvorak.
I know. I use my real name, too.
Why fool around?
Yeah. Facebook does insist on real names. It does make it a little bit nicer climate in there. It also makes it the place to go for news. I mentioned I was going to talk about this.
Oh, yeah. Ha.
Well, but the Pew studies have said for some time that this is how young
reporters
people
and I would, yeah, get news. Young people. Young people.
Matthew Ingram writing for your journal, Philip.
Yes, he's one of the hires we got
from
GigaOM. Those guys are great. It really raised the level. It put some pressure on me. I realized I had to play a tougher game with these guys around. And Matthew's wonderful. He's so smart.
Yeah.
And they're trying to turn him into a clickho. So
what? There's pressure to generate traffic at Fortune Magazine?
Oh, my God, yeah. He says, you know, I can only write 1,000 words. And someone said, well, you better learn how to write shorter than that.
Well, yeah, it's probably true. It's probably the case that people don't read more than 1,000 words.
Mm-hmm. They rarely read
Although,
that
look
much.
At Medium. Medium's doing nice, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I never go to that thing.
I don't think. I mean, they've got good stuff. I'm not sure they're successful.
No, maybe not.
Economically.
According to Parsley, which is the best name ever, PARS.LY. It's a traffic analytics firm. Google now accounts, I'm sorry, Facebook now accounts for more of the traffic to news sites than Google.
That's got to bother them.
I don't think that's, I have some question about that.
Ah.
We don't see that here.
Oh, tell me what your traffic looks like.
So Facebook on any given day is probably about maybe 5% of our referral traffic.
Yeah.
The vast majority of it comes from other referrals, our homepage. I think people that look for local media still go, oh, I want to go see what's happening, so I'll go to the Chronicle.
That's rare. I don't think most people go to front pages anymore. I certainly don't.
My wife does.
I think for hometown papers, if you want to know what's happening.
Right. You don't Google a hometown story, right?
I think you do, right?
That makes sense.
And that's our bread and butter. But one thing I can say is that, because this is my job now, is I can see our traffic from Facebook, from Twitter, increasing as the homepage declines. That is true.
Yeah. Do you have a concerted effort to post on Facebook? I mean, are you trying to drive traffic?
Yes. We probably post at least every 30 minutes stories from both our premium site and our free site. You know, we have that strategy of a free and premium. And some of them really take off. Some of them don't. But it is a but we definitely, and when we don't post a story that people are expecting to see, we hear about it. So they are coming to Facebook looking for it. That I don't think that used to be the case, but I think people now get on Facebook and say, I'm going to see what the news is.
I'm looking at Fortune's traffic right now, this exact moment. 1,066 viewers from Google, 562 from email apps and IM, 140 from newsgoogle.com. 129 from AOL.com, 79 from Facebook.
Wow.
Aha.
But if you went to Vice or BuzzFeed, obviously they're skewing it. They aim at a younger demographic. Facebook, perhaps,
this could
more
all
important
be
to them.
BS. Or just to give Facebook the reputation they don't deserve.
Facebook certainly wants news. They've got, like Apple, they've got their own news interface. They've clearly been tweaking the news feed to be more newsy.
Yeah, and they're huge is the thing. That's why I'm willing to believe this, because Facebook is so big.
Yeah.
And it's really about people going to read stories, whereas Google is really, you know, a search engine.
We're seeing, though, a lot of stats about Facebook that people are now questioning, things like 1.5 billion monthly active users. And people say that's not right. That
doesn't sound right to me.
Yeah. Boy, Facebook owned the Fox GOP debate, though, didn't they? They were all over that.
Well, I thought it was really awkward the way they tried to put the Facebook questions in.
There was somebody.
They were terrible questions, too, by the way. Mm-hmm.
Somebody brought up the subtle subliminal messaging that took place in that thing. And, of course, we know that Fox probably doesn't like Donald Trump, among others, where you see a Republican candidate and then the big letter F, which means flunk.
Because you did. In every shot, there was a Facebook F.
Yes, and it's subliminally telling you that these guys are flunks,
or
losers.
F stands for Fox.
No, it was they had the Fox logo there.
Why would Fox want to deprecate all the GOP candidates?
We've never been convinced that they're not a front for the Democrats.
Roger Ailes is not a front for the
I'm
Democrats.
I'm telling you. There's I think the way they went after Trump was a good example.
Well, we talked about this actually in the early show, and I said the words I thought I'd never say was thank God for Fox News that they hit those candidates with such hard questions, and no other network could have done it without being accused of being hard on the Republicans.
Same reason only Nixon could open China.
Yeah, well,
right. So and I think that what I've read is that Ailes and Murdoch were really trying to push Trump out for the good of the Republican Party, and they were going to choose that debate to do it.
Oh, I think Ailes loved Trump because Ailes knew that Trump was a ratings.
Well, that's true.
I think after the fact, they didn't know in advance it was.
Oh, they knew. That's why they had him on Hannity and O'Reilly every day leading up to that debate. They knew. They knew very well.
You know, there's a movement right now going on to get Jon Stewart to moderate a debate.
There is something like 65,000 signatures on the petition.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Yes, let's put a comic in charge.
May as well.
Why not?
The field are full of comics.
Here's somebody we can all agree on. Comcast. They apparently want to create their own internet, ladies and gentlemen. They've created something called Watchable, which is a streaming portal. They want creators to, but you have to be a Comcast subscriber with an X1 box to see it. They're also releasing a live streaming app called Xfinity Share that allows all Comcast customers to broadcast to other subscribers' TVs and smartphones. So it's really kind of the Comcast internet.
I think it's not going to work.
It's a terrible idea. But that's what AOL did, right? That's what all these guys do. Facebook wants to be the internet. For a lot of people, Facebook is the internet.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, it's like AOL used to be.
Right, right.
AOL was the internet for a lot of people.
All right, I think we can... I don't want to do that.
What? What?
Australians, you got to love them. There's this sign-in thing on Windows 10 called Microsoft Hello, and the idea is that if you have a special camera that has Z-Depth, like the Kinect or Intel camera, that it will do face recognition and you can sign on with face recognition. But of course, the question is, well, what if somebody impersonates you or holds up a sign? So the Australian got 8 identical twins and to see if they could fool.
Could they?
No.
They couldn't?
No, and these kids look pretty identical.
I was in Portugal and it was a few years ago when they had one of these systems and I did everything I could. Stuff my cheeks with cotton and all this stuff to get these things to not recognize me, and they always
they're pretty
work.
Good. You know what they do is they measure the distance between the eyes, the length of the nose. I think there's metrics of the face that they use that are apparently like a fingerprint, not very unique, almost unique. Anyway, Windows Hello passed the test.
Hmm. Another thing that sounds bad.
Hello. Anyway, I wasn't going to do this story, but you made me do it.
Yeah, we did it.
Hey, what could possibly go wrong with 8 sets of adorable identical twins? They're just adorable.
There were no ugly twins.
No ugly twins.
No ugly twins.
I think we could stop now.
Yeah, 49ers await.
49ers await.
Has it started?
I don't know. I don't care.
Probably.
It's preseason. It doesn't matter.
It does matter.
Last game, Kaepernick had one.
No, but he's going to play a quarter and a half this time. You can count on that.
Cool. Ladies and gentlemen, that's John C. Dvorak. We, just come back every week because you might as well.
NoAgendaShow.com. Check it out. When you can.
When can I get you off of that show onto our show?
I'm on the show right now, if you haven't noticed.
Oh, nice job. Anything else you would like to plug?
Not really. I'm working on the vinegar book. It will be done.
I want the vinegar book. And then you will host the new screensavers with me.
Once the book is done, yes. It'll be a screensavers vinegar show.
Filmer.
Hey, Filmer, how you doing? Keep saying Filmer.
Am I the only guy that does that? That's a spoonerism, isn't it?
We take a shot every time you say it.
I'm the only guy who does that. Philip Elmer DeWitt.
Filmer.
He is at Fortune. Used to be a writer at Time, then he did that porn thing. And
that was it for him. Became an editor.
Actually, I love Philip Elmer DeWitt. I always wanted to get him on the shows, and I'm glad we do. Thank you for being here. We appreciate it.
Thanks,
the most relaxed guest we have. He sits back. He relaxes.
Yeah, he's like in the middle of nowhere somewhere out there.
Are you
East Coast.
Stockbridge? Where are you?
I'm in Greenfield, Massachusetts. Right. And we do have cell coverage, but all the hill towns around us don't. Yeah.
What do they do for entertainment?
They watch the grass. It's growing.
They smoke pot is what they
do. It's a pot smoking area.
And then they think they
man,
have.
Phil. Oh, man, I got four bars, man. Look at that. What a movie.
Mr. Dwight Silverman from the Houston Chronicle. It's blog.cron.com/techblog at D Silverman on the Twitter. Just
I always
want
to call him Philip Head. You know, I talk now in people's handles.
He's a Philip Head.
I always want to call him Philip Head.
Well, it is Philip E.D., right?
Philip E.D., yeah, right.
Philip Head.
But it was all I could do when we were talking to not address him as
Actually,
Philip Head.
You're right. When I don't know somebody, I only know them from Twitter, I often want to use their Twitter handle.
I'm usually P.E.D., but that was taken, so yeah. I had to go Philip Head.
Philip Head.
Well, I should remind people to go to the Twitter and put the real Dvorak on their list.
See what happens. Penn Jillette is apparently from Greenfield, Massachusetts. Did you know that, Ped?
Yes, I did. I did.
Ped. Getting dingy
on it. You know, I will be back next week, right before Twit, for the hour before Twit. We're going to do an Ask Me Anything, an AMA. Not with Reddit, but with Product Hunt. I'm really excited about this. We got to know Ryan on Triangulation, Ryan Hoover, the creator of Product Hunt. It's a great site for finding new and interesting stuff, and they decided to start doing Ask Me Anythings. So we will be doing one, and I'll be broadcasting it while I do it, which I think will be kind of fun, between right an hour before Twit next week.
So this is the time to harass Leo.
You can harass me. You can ask me mean questions.
Be mean.
I've done a couple of Reddit AMAs. I don't know what else there is to ask, but if you can find something, that'd be great. You can find out more at our blog.
Asked out?
I just feel like there's not that much to say. I mean, I'm an open book, but maybe you'll find something new.
I will. I'm going to come on and do it.
Troll me. Yeah, it's inside.twit.tv is our blog, and details, links, and all of that stuff. Will be there. And if you're not a member of Product Hunt, create an account right now so you can do that.
I found a great product there today, the cat purr generator.
I think, I see it right here. I think Product Hunt is awesome.
It's awesome.
So what do? You just do it? You press it?
It's like an equalizer for cat purr. You can adjust and get different kinds of purrs. Crank up the bass. If you hit the low sliders, and you got a good subwoofer, it's pretty awesome. I freak my cats out with it today.
Listen.
That's a big cat.
That's a big cat.
It'll scare the crap out of anything.
Why do cats purr? Really, what's going on with that?
There's some speculation that it's like a self-healing thing. There's a description there on it that the frequencies apparently have something to do with health and healing. I don't know if I believe that.
I don't believe it.
You know,
like something
I do believe
Berkeley.
That. You know why? Because whenever I'm in pain, I moan. I'm a moaner.
You're a moaner?
I'm a moaner.
You're a moaner.
And have you? Well, if you're, you know,
we know you're a moaner and groaner, but I didn't know you're just
a moaner.
Moaner.
If you have pain, try that. Go, oh. It drives everybody in the house crazy, but you feel
but you
better.
Feel bad.
So you're doing this around the house constantly.
Constantly. Because I'm in pain a lot. But maybe I should try purring.
There are some presets there on the right where you can have contented, down on the where in the blue links down there on the right.
Here's Tranquil.
Sounds like snoring.
That's Tranquil. Here's Tiger Sleep. Oh yeah, that's the deep bass right in there. Yeah, you can hardly hear it.
Yeah, you have to crank it.
It's like a thrum.
Right.
Thrum.
Thrumming.
All right, we're done.
We actually, you know what we did? We got cats.
And they purr. Cats?
Well, you just get cats.
What about them?
You don't need a purr generator. You just get cats.
They crap.
That's true. The purr generator never crapped.
It does. Nope.
Does not crap. Our show is broadcast live, so you can watch live. And usually you should, because the best stuff is almost always cut out. That's at 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, 2200 UTC on twit.tv/live. You can also get after the fact on-demand audio and video at twit.tv or wherever you get your favorite podcasts. And if you'd like to be in studio like the German family, they're not the German family. They're the family from Germany. But anyway, they're nice people.
They're from Stuttgart.
No, they're not from Stuttgart. Oh, they're from the Black Forest. The Black Forest.
I like to say Stuttgart.
Stuttgart.
Yeah.
If you'd like to be in studio, you just email tickets at twit.tv. We'll put out a chair for you. That's all I can promise. Thank you so much for being here. We'll see you later. Another twit is in the can. Bye-bye. Polite applause.